Hello, welcome along to the Best of the Old Great Whistle Test. This is DVD number 2, charting the history of the programme through its 15 years on BBC television. We're going to see a selection of some of the great performances from the show during that time. Beginning in 1971 with Heads, Hands and Feet, one of the people to look out for on this performance is guitarist Albert Lee, who's still fantastically active, really has established a reputation now as being one of the great all-time guitarists in the world. I saw him on stage at the Albert Hall at the George Harrison tribute concert in 2002. I've seen him on stage in Nashville and at bluegrass festivals. He really is a fantastic performer. And here he is in the studio with Heads, Hands and Feet.
Well, I'm David Hepworth, and I started as one of the Whistle Test presenters in, I think, about 1981, and went through to, I think, about 1984-85, and the archivist is Mark Ellen, who can
remember. Got all the dates. Facts and fingers at my fingertips. Facts and fingers? Can't be right. No, I started in, 1982, I think, with you, did the late-night programme, and then went through with the cast of thousands, with Roe Newton and Andy Kershaw, the man they call Richard Skinner, till about, I don't know, 87, I think it was.
Something like that.
And we're here in this little booth, not wearing our badges. I know just Bob's got his badge, and we really don't have our badge on, and watching Heads, Hands and Feet, and who I vaguely recall.
I've got some Heads, Hands and Feet records, actually, and I really liked them. I thought they were terribly good. Now, there's the guy that Bob didn't mention. He talks about Albert Lee, who is obviously a very well-known guitar player.
It was his geezer.
But the chap playing bass there went on to have numerous top 10 hits, I think.
Is he Scottish? Is it Manny Charlton of Nazareth?
It's not Manny Charlton of Nazareth.
Is it Roger Chapman?
I think we're just going to leave that, let that hang for a while.
Is it Jeremy Beadle?
There he is again. Who could
there
that
is.
Be?
Plays the bass.
Part of
what did
a
he
duo.
Go on to be?
Part of a duo. Had, I would imagine, top 5 hit records in the 70s and 80s.
Actually, I think I've probably got the answer. Dare I go in with it?
Yeah, go on, you go.
Could it possibly be one of Chaz or Dave? Could it be Dave or indeed Chaz?
It is, in fact, not him, not the guy we got there, who is whose name I can't remember. It is Chaz Hodges.
Chaz Hodges.
Out of Chaz and Dave.
Out of Chaz and Dave, who did Gertrude.
And Rabbit. And well-known Tottenham Hotspur fans.
But with there the legendary line, got more rabbits than Sainsbury's. Do you remember that? Ah, that was songwriting.
But there's Albert Lee. And if you want to get into the deep, dark undergrowth of trivia, him...
Who's that guy?
He, that is Tony Colton, who produced the first album by Yes. It's not
so stay with us, listeners. It gets better.
It's not
I should make a note of that.
Trivia, but it is trivia.
That is Chaz, isn't that extraordinary? Bob should have picked that out.
This is warming up the band, which is just obviously one of those numbers that they just started the set with, wasn't it?
Yeah, I don't remember them that. Did you ever see them?
I may have seen them. They made an album called Tracks.
Great title. Tracks, hey.
And an album called Old Soldiers Never Die, which is terrifically good. And I think they were the kind of thing that, you know, there was no sort of call for a British band who sounded like this if you wanted this kind of thing.
No, you must have got the American...
But they were good.
Fact, and think how many people looked like that in 1971.
Chaz Hodges modelling the Grandad vest, which is a big favourite of the time.
It was.
Tony Colton.
There was one stage where I think it was almost compulsory to be on the programme if you didn't have a Grandad vest.
And Albert Lee wearing a fairly skimpy top.
Albert Lee, he was signed to A&M in the 70s. Do you remember when they thought they were getting Alvin Lee?
They thought they were getting Albert Lee. And they got Albert by mistake.
They got Albert Lee.
To be truthful, I don't actually remember very much about my first appearance on the Grey Whistle Test. I know it was exciting because it was the only program that was sort of offered airtime to, I don't know what you call it, alternative, did we agree on that? Or people who weren't top 50, basically. So it was a really good thing. I don't remember much about it except that it was kind of sterile in a way because you were stuck at the back of this horribly lighted studio and just told to play. And I think that the clip that you play, I think we did that live. It's very hard to do that with no audience and no kind of feedback. So we all look a bit out of place, basically. In that band, that was one of the incarnations of a group I had called The Whole World. David Bedford, Mike Oldfield, Mick Fincher, and Lowell Coxhill, and myself. And I think that those were very early days, in fact. That clip, I can see the way that, from the way that people are standing or sitting, that they were not used to being live. Neither was I, for that matter.
So we better do the Kevin Ayers story, really, haven't we?
Kevin Ayers. I was an enormous admirer of Kevin Ayers. Can I say?
Member of the Soft...
And he looks good at this stage, isn't he? Member of the Soft Boys?
No.
Soft Boys, Soft Machine. We're talking about the Soft Machine.
Briefly a member of the Soft Machine, wasn't he? I think.
Yeah, very
briefly. Very early on.
Finished up living in France. Made a bit of a wine fancier. Wasn't he?
Bit of a high liver, I think.
High liver. Kevin, bit of a roué.
Roué. Yes.
Dad worked at the...
I think Dad. I once met Kevin Ayers' dad.
Rowan Ayers, right?
Something like that. Yeah. He was a kind of senior bod at the BBC at some stage. And Mike Upton, who was the producer of Whistle Test, used to know this guy. I was sort of had work for him, I think. Anyway, I remember I met him. Kevin Ayers records, a few of them just reissued recently. And I have to say, they sound terribly good.
They're really good. They made an album called... In fact, that's Mike Oldfield on the right. You can't see now. Mike Oldfield.
Playing the bass.
And how old is he? 18 years
Pretty
old.
Pretty young.
No, really, he's born in 54, and I think it's recorded in whatever it was, 78 or something? I can't remember.
No, got it wrong. 72. Anyway, he was pretty young. And the great Lowell Coxhill... On
it was quite often. There he is on the left. There's Mike Oldfield on the right, wasn't it? Yeah. Coxhill used to busk on the Embankment Bridge when he went over to the South Bank. He'd often be there with his hat playing the clarinet or whatever.
And there's an unconfirmed story, which won't get anybody into trouble, that Joni Mitchell wrote for free after seeing Lowell Coxhill.
Oh, right, yes.
Busking.
Saw him busking in London.
You know, and the one-man band by the Quick Lunch Stand, he was playing real good for free.
Certainly a story that old Coxhill made no attempt to deny.
And you wouldn't.
So the people like us are still talking about it.
Yes, absolutely.
No, they were really good.
And it's just the quality of his voice, really, isn't it? And it's, you know, the records that last the best are very often the things that are the sparest. You know, it's kind of like Nick Drake. And
it is.
Like that,
yeah, it had
just
a real, voice. It's a real pastoral kind of whimsy. And then he made a record called Whatever She Brings, We Sing.
Great
Still
song.
A great record. And the gatefold in that had a picture of Kevin Ayers thrashing about in a river in a pair of underpants with an incredibly attractive girl with long hair. And I can remember at the age of whatever it was, 15, thinking, that's the job I want. I want to be Kevin Ayers.
I've got the pants.
it seemed to beat working.
None of these guys have spent a long time in makeup prior to this this recording, have they?
Kevin has a girl like Julian Cope in this clip.
Yes, it does, doesn't it?
And to some extent, it was a sort of Julian Cope figure, I think.
Yes. I just came in off
the street. And even sings, quite posh, and even sings with a vaguely posh accent,
yes,
doesn't he?
Which is a hard thing
proper
to do.
Proper psychedelic whimsy of the kind of... it was Canterbury. The Canterbury scene was
they
the
all came
machine,
out of Canterbury.
Came from Canterbury. The Caravan and all those guys.
Robert Wyatt.
Robert Wyatt.
Mike Ratledge and Hugh Hopper. Is that right?
Hugh Hopper, absolutely right. And look at that necklace. Fantastic necklace, look. From the King's Road. Take six.
That jacket must have been comfy. He's wearing a pair of.
Sensational loons from Oldfield
two
on the
pounds,
right.
£2 loons from Kensington Market, the kind of thing that used to
he was
bisect.
£2.
That's
right. Who is on the left? Is that David Bedford? No, who's the guy playing the...
It's Bedford playing.
I think
it
is David Bedford. He used to do all those... David Bedford's the name you associated with all those orchestral arrangements for rock things at the Albert Hall.
He was, he did the orchestral tubular bells.
The hat's got to go, hasn't it?
Roxy Music, when I saw them, were just the oddest band I'd ever seen, really. And it was around that time when there was a lot of emphasis being placed again on how people looked, you know, and not just how they sounded. They definitely weren't one of those kind of blues-based bands that had come out of that university circuit in England. This was something new. And this is just like a great clip, apart from anything else, just to see the kind of technology they used then, the sort of stuff that Brian Eno was using and everything, which was new then, but I suppose it's vintage gear these days.
I've become a bit of a boffin through necessity, and I don't just like guitars, I also like vintage synthesizers. So one thing I vividly remember is Roxy Music's performance of Ladytron in the Old Grey Whistle Test, when Phil Manzanera, Roxy's guitarist, had his axe fed through this little early British synthesizer called the VCS3, also called the Putney, because I think it was designed in Putney. And Brian Eno could treat any guitars or vocal sounds or Andy Mackay's saxophone sounds through the synthesizer, which was keyboardless. And looking back on this performance now, and I can remember at the time, it just seemed like the future.
That's the old mirror ball, isn't it? That's when they really splashed out on the on the special effects. I'm trying to work out.
I can remember this, you know, because this is quite controversial. They were on the Old Grey Whistle Test. Yes. It's very much at odds with the, yes, the more American fair, the prevailing ethic. In fact, I don't think Bob was even that enthusiastic about it. Did he try and disassociate himself with this one? I can't remember that.
I'm trying to work out who that bass player is. Is that. Is it Davey O'List? Anyway, Andy Mackay.
Andy Mackay, good jacket.
Andy Mackay, man who went on to write Rock Follies, which we'll pass over.
Yes, he did. Yeah, is that collar big enough, do you think? I could have had a slightly bigger one. Good stiff breeze. Now, this is... Do you remember this now? You know, you get a kind of leopard skin arm with a gold lame glove adjusting the volume levels of a fairly primitive piece of...
It's a telephone exchange.
It's a telephone, it's a switchboard.
I'm
just putting you through.
There he is.
And I can remember that being fantastically exciting. You know, remember the time when gear itself was just exactly what Edwin Collins was talking about in that... In that link, just seeing gear. I remember going to see Yes in 1971 at the Southampton Gaumont, and Rick Wakeman had three keyboards. And I just remember thinking, wow, you know, to be able to play just, one would be amazing.
Numbers.
He's so good, he's got to have three.
Yeah.
And he plays two of them at once.
I think I've just spotted the fact that Brian Ferry's keyboard isn't plugged in.
Not plugged in.
Not so, one of his greater hairstyles.
I don't know. I think the ladies would probably disagree with
I think he had better periods, actually.
No, that's not it. But the GI period was very good.
Yeah, that was it.
But interesting pop fact of a whistle test related nature. Didn't Richard Williams, the original presenter, sign Roxy Music to Island Records?
He did. And also signed Kevin Ayers to Island Records.
A little bit of a theme emerging here.
Phil Manzanera with the kind of bug spectacles.
Kind of pre-Bono of the mid-90s.
And the guy who never looked entirely at home in Roxy Music, although a fabulous musician. Where is he? Is the drummer, Paul Thompson.
Oh, Thompson. Didn't he used to wear that off-the-shoulder sort of strange kind of I'm in a circus type T-shirt?
He always...
A leopard skin T-shirt with only one shoulder on it. He always looked as if, do I have to wear this?
Absolutely. That was the famous feature.
I'm not getting paid enough. I do not have to look this ridiculous.
There's always one member of a band who looks as if somebody's forced him to wear a uniform. And he really doesn't
really
want
under
to. Here he is. Here he is.
And we're about to see him. What's he got on?
Oh, no,
a bit of glitter.
We missed him again.
But it's very whistle test, that direction, is that if someone was playing a solo, you always got a close-up of their particular instrument.
Yeah.
And quite often missed some other little details that were going on because you were looking at the frantic fretwork of, Andy Mackay or whatever.
So this is off their first album?
Yeah, first album. It's the first album, yeah. And this was the lineup that played Lincoln Festival.
Was it?
And Reading. I can remember.
I want to know that bass.
That's
player.
The guy. Look, this
is
guy.
David.
I remember Henry Cow,
is
isn't
that, it? Is it David O'List or is it Rick Kenton?
Rick Kenton. He's probably listening.
Answers on a postcard.
He's probably listening.
Viewers.
He's going, it's me. You're probably really upsetting the bloke.
Yeah,
good clothes, though, surely. Look at that.
Ooh. Now, this isn't live, is it?
I don't know, because at this period... Well, I think we come
this
to that
is
later
before
in
my
the,
time.
We come to that later in the disc, but there was a sort of musicians' union problem where people had to...
Well, the BBC
had
used
to mind
a whole
to their backing
union,
track.
Probably.
I don't know, I think this probably is live. it's a phenomenal piece of acting. If it is,
yeah, you've given it loads.
It convinced me. Brian Eno, should have seen more of him. Looked Brian, very good.
Brian Eno, can you take a message?
Touch and makeup. Yes, good job. She's not in. She'll be back on Tuesday. She's on holiday. He's on the phone at the moment. He's in a meeting.
Great man. Great man.
I remember the great excitement. He was spotted in Guildford, driving through Guildford on a scooter once.
Brian Eno.
16, Brian Eno on a scooter. And this travelled across the local telegraph like wildfire.
And because still, extraordinary still thrilling.
The idea that he'd been to Guildford at all seemed absolutely mind-bending.
But, you know, of all the people that you might see on looking at old footage like this, you know, Brian Eno's just had a fantastic career where he seems to have just done what he wanted.
Yeah, he has.
And had his name on some fantastic
immense
work.
Amounts of control.
U2 and Talking Heads.
You imagine he must have been slightly devastated he didn't stay in the group longer than one album or whatever it was. He left really soon, didn't he? Are they mine? Can we tell?
I think they are. This is the tiny little studio, isn't it? This is what they used to call the continuity studio, where which is just about big enough to do the weathering.
Well, everybody talked about that, and I think talked about that in these in interviews, and Mike Appleton mentions it too. You know, the idea that they used to play these massive stadiums in this tiny little room.
Whistletest was born in September 1971. Prior to that, I'd been working on a programme called Late Night Lineup. This had closed down the BBC Two network right from its inception. It had also spawned a couple of music programmes. One was called Colour Me Pop, and as the name denoted, it was to celebrate television going into colour. And the second one was called Disco 2. These had both come to their run's end. And Late Night Lineup was also coming to the end of its run. And I had to decide on a career move what I was going to do, and I wasn't too sure. And then I came across an album called Sweet Baby James by James Taylor. And listening to that, I decided this was what I wanted to do. I wanted to go into music television. I wanted to create something that was different, that hadn't been created before. And so Whistletest came to be born. And it was people like James Taylor, the singer-songwriters of that period, who were very strong at the time, who were very influential on the early days of the show. One such couple were Americans, Kenny Loggins and Jim Messina, Loggins and Messina, and they came in to perform a fairly quaintly titled song called A House at Pooh Corner. And I suspect they thought we were quite quaint as well, because they would be used to American-style presentation with all the razzmatazz that went with it. And they came into our tiny little studio, bare walls and three cameras and very little razzmatazz. And I should think they were probably in a state of shock initially, but nevertheless, they gave us a great performance.
My name is Kenny Loggins, and I just finished doing an album with a fellow named Jimmy Messina. I'd like to introduce him to you now. Jimmy Messina.
Bit of an effort there to generate a bit of excitement in this tiny little, rather cold studio. They've done well. And Loggins on the left, Dave. That hair's been styled.
That's the arrival of the hairdresser in Rock.
Yeah. No member of Head's hands and feet look like that. It's a feather cut. I'm calling it a feather cut. Remember?
People used to have long hair because they just didn't cut it until the arrival of things like that.
Yeah.
That's carefully considered long hair, isn't it?
I think this man's heard of hair conditioner.
Products.
So Jim Messina. Jim Messina was a member of Buffalo Springfield, wasn't he?
And moved on to
go on.
Poco.
With who? With what? Richie Fura
and George Grantham.
Oh,
Rusty Young. Ooh, got me going.
Now. Oh, Lord. And enough already.
It's terrible. You suddenly, all these names pop up and you find yourself, you're trying to visualise an old Pete Frame family tree.
Oh, yeah,
and suddenly
absolutely.
You see these other names and just in the... in the hinterland. And Jim Messina produced this record and eventually took such a part in it that they sort of made it a duo record and called it Sittin' In. With the apostrophe.
Sittin'. Yeah. Which is very, very relaxing. The kind of Marin County thing where you were so relaxed you couldn't finish your punctuation.
Yeah, but this was in the days when they always had pictures of the band in the studio. You know, there's always a lot of emphasis on on here they are doing
yeah.
this. Do you know what I mean?
And, oh, it's
and headphones
part
and
of
cables
the
and
romantic like. Fantasy.
Yeah.
Very quaint title, though. Psychedelic whimsy.
Winnie the Pooh.
Return to childhood. All very fashionable at the time.
Sold a lot of records, these guys. And then Kenny Loggins, of course, went on to write the theme from Footloose.
You imagine they made a huge amount of money, then went and lived on a farm somewhere for about 10 years.
No, they didn't. Kenny Loggins still around.
Back to the wares of a Christopher Robin. Back to the days of Pooh. Oh,
best things about Whistle Test. Well, first thing that comes to mind is that unlike other pop shows of the time, like Top of the Pops, for instance, they would have you there at 9 o'clock in the morning and you would be on stage at 10 o'clock in the morning singing your hit song of the time. And let me tell you, for a rock band in those days to be anywhere else but in bed or shagging a bird at 10 o'clock in the morning was not anywhere you wanted to be. So Whistle Test was incredibly civilised because they didn't used to start doing anything until at least after 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And everything was very casual. You kind of turn up and no pressure. It'd be a live vocal on the backing track. I vaguely remember that we used to have to go through a whole charade for the Musicians' Union because at the time we had to, they wouldn't let us use our own backing tracks. Even though it was us playing on our backing tracks, no one else was on them. They used to have to go through this, we used to have to go through a whole charade of pretending that we recorded it for the show. God knows why, because it made us an awful lot of work that we didn't want to do. And most of the time we used to just be pulling the wool over the Musicians' Union guy. He used to actually stand in the control room with the engineer to make sure that we were out there recording this stuff. And it just shows you what kind of musicians this was from the Musicians' Union, because we would be playing completely different stuff than when actually coming out of the speakers that he was listening to. Because what he was listening to was the original track anyway. It was all a sham. That went on for years and years and years, and it brings back really great fond memories of how stupid they were, how bright we were, and still are, and what a waste of time the Musicians' Union is, because it's if you're in a trumpet player in a weddings band in Tunbridge Wells, it's very good for you, but for big rock and roll bands, they were death.
A bit of politics there from Roger Daltrey and that link preceding this.
I can back him up on that, actually, because I worked briefly as a record plugger, and the deal was with Top of the Pops that you used to be given 3 hours to re-record your song.
Oh, I remember, that's
song.
Right, yeah.
And you'd have to go into a studio with an MU representative observer and supposedly do again, you know, your record that you'd spent months doing. And the custom was for the engineer at the end of the session to take the MU guy round the pub for a drink.
And you swap the tapes.
Or you swap the tapes.
To swap the tapes. And it's the MU guy was either so profoundly dense.
Well, he got paid for doing it.
Exactly.
He didn't,
realise that there had been no 27-piece orchestra in that tiny
this
room.
It's what they call in the print business Spanish practices, isn't it?
I researched this clip.
Go on.
And they are miming. But it's
definitely
a live vocal.
Because look, there's no mics on that drum.
There's no mics at all. He's not really hitting the drums. Actually, look
he's
at this
doing a good. He's doing a good job of not hitting it. Actually, he's giving,
the vocal.
Giving
the vocal is live. But if you see Pete Townsend, he's actually putting a fairly good performance there.
Yeah.
He's not. He's not quite. His fingers don't quite. You know, kind of coordinate with the noise that's coming out.
It's good.
But you get the most fantastic facial expressions from Keith Moon. Occasionally, I mean, about a minute's time, there's a little close-up between the two of them, and he's just grimacing at the camera.
Because two members of this group no longer with us.
That's right. Well, one of them, Keith. I served him champagne, Dave, a week before he died. He died on the 8th of September, I think it was, 1978. I was a champagne waiter at the Berkeley Square Ball, and he was there. Not playing drums, you know what I'm saying? And he was there, with a big old bunch of mates, hooking down the booze. And he actually looked in a pretty terrible old state, put on a lot of weight. And
This is a great record. I like this period of the Who. I don't think this was ever on an album. This was an odd single.
This is Relay from Lifehouse Project.
Oh, right.
Which was a sort of indulgence that Townsend had got involved in, and then he dumped.
It's what became Who's Next. They started off doing this project called the Lifehouse Project, and then they did this
which he tried to revive, didn't he, recently? He made a thing for VH1.
Well, no, all this stuff's been reissued recently. All the old Vic tapes came out recently. And they were just making some sensational records at the time. And, of course, all the girls loved Roger.
They did.
All the blokes try to grow their hair like Roger.
Roger swinging the microphone.
He used to take his shirt off a lot. When people didn't do that very often, actually. Because most rock stars were so skinny and pasty, they couldn't get away with it.
Roger Daltrey and thought, that's it, taking your shirt off is the way forward. And for many of them, it's probably a mistake. Their audience is begging to put the shirts back on. The Ox.
The Ox.
Phenomenal musician.
Great musician.
Wrote one song, Boris the Spider. Was it one?
Yeah, well, I'm sure he wrote more than one. But Boris the Spider is probably one of the best known.
These great close-ups of Keith Moon. Absolutely brilliant.
There is the theory that all the great groups have this lineup,
Nowhere to hide. You have a singer, a guitarist, a bassist, and a drummer.
Nowhere to hide.
So Led Zeppelin, Smiths,
R.E.M.,
Stone Roses,
R.E.M.
Free, R.E.M. Must be some more of them.
Those are pretty good. You've got to be good in the four-piece crew. Good.
No rhythm guitar necessary to fill in gaps.
Great sing. I mean, they really are giving it plenty, aren't they? Considering they're in front of three blokes with cardigans.
You know, and they've just spent 3 hours dealing with some musician's union trying to get to re-record the track. To be fair, they're giving it their best shot.
They are. You see, he would be twirling his mic if he had more space, wouldn't he? But he didn't dare. He's going to knock somebody.
The Whistle Test studio would have allowed that, actually.
You couldn't swing a cat or
right,
a mic.
Right in front of them would be a load of guys in old anoraks, blokes in their 50s.
Yeah.
Who are just going to go on and do Newsnight later on.
Just been doing the good life.
They've just been doing the good life, that's right. Jim will fix it 4:30. And some group called The Who at 2:00. Only one of whom appeared to be singing.
It's funny, actually, how some performances really stand out in the memory. And one of the people I vividly remember meeting for the first time while I was doing the programme was Judy Sill, who came in to do a song called Jesus Was a Crossmaker. A lot of people remember this song. It was released on Asylum in 1973. And she seemed so unlikely to me when she first came into the studio. She looked every bit the librarian. She had horn-rimmed glasses on and was pretty severe, actually. In fact, she was saying into camera, just as she was performing the songs, please buy my records so that I don't have to open up for these snotty rock stars anymore. Well, she did come back into the studio again later to perform a couple of the songs from her second release, and this is one of those songs.
And this song is about the union of opposites that we all have, and the kiss is a symbol of the union.
Oh, the girl singer-songwriters. Oh, Dave.
You're
there were
right.
thousands. At one point, you were just ankle-deep in them, weren't you? They were everywhere. Thousands of them.
Interesting case, this one. Grew up in kind of Hollywood family, as far as I know. Quite well-connected. And had torrid teenage years. Ran away from home. Terrible problems with her father. And drug abuse on a grand scale.
God, you wouldn't think that to look at it, would
you?
You
wouldn't really.
Yeah.
And then somehow got into playing music and made, as Bob says, I think two albums for Asylum.
And died in what they called mysterious circumstances.
Yes, no, entirely sure. I mean,
years later?
Yeah,
74?
I think she died later than that, actually. But sort of retired from music business. It's terribly sad. But the one, as Bob says, the one that everybody remembers, Jesus Was a Crossmaker. Once heard, never forgotten. And I want to try and get it somehow. This is off an album called Heart Food, I think. And this is the time when Asylum was the record company that everybody wanted to be with, the company that started by David Geffen and Elliot Roberts. They had the Eagles and Jackson Brown. The cream of the West Coast. And she was on Asylum. And they used to... People... The thing about American acts, they came over here, the thing they could never believe was that there was a program that would let them go on and play.
Absolutely.
Like this. Because there's nothing like this, yeah, in America. Wasn't then, isn't now, never will be. You know, this sort of stuff doesn't exist on network television
but
in America.
This was the perfect environment for it. And, that, and in a way, it was the program was sort of, as Mike said earlier, about James Taylor, it was sort of form, wasn't it, for this kind of musical experience.
But the fact is, you could go on Whistle Test on a Tuesday night or whenever it was, you know, 11:15, and you would reach all the people in the country who could conceivably be interested.
And would probably go out and buy your record.
Would buy your record. Absolutely. And go and buy a ticket for your,
yeah,
tour.
Yeah.
You know, if you were one of the kind of acts that made that sort of impact. You know, and you can remember it happened with the oddest...
And
with
the oddest
people.
Oh, gosh, I mean, I can't think all those kind of Buffy St. Marie, Phoebe Snow, Janice Ian, you know, Laura Nyro, all those people, many people I think probably were on the programme. But the other thing about that is this stuff actually really worked on the television. It made really good, close, kind of intimate television. Where often,
yeah,
the big rock band playing some massive stage
is reduced.
Could not be contained in this little rather chilly studio. Whereas this stuff really, really, you know, communicated very directly. Reach me with a ray. Silently swooping down just to show me how to give my heart away. Also, this is in the days before the remote control. Come fill my heart. When if you wanted to change the channel, you had to get up and go and switch it. Many people wouldn't have been bothered. Well, this kind of thing wouldn't exist on television. It wouldn't exist, no. Because you were just stuck into this singular experience for 4 minutes. And it always said a lot, I think, for people's investment in Whistle Test and in this kind of music. They were prepared to put up with,
yeah,
loads of stuff they probably wouldn't be remotely interested in the hope that band X would, yeah, appear at the end. So she kind of faded out completely. Is she ever name checked by people?
Yeah, I think she does get mentioned. It's sort of, yeah, you'll get contemporary singer songwriters who will invoke her name, very much like the Will Joni Mitchell. And, you know, this kind of music's sort of fashionable again, isn't it? Communion of a kiss.
Well, I was absolutely thrilled when this next band first appeared on Whistle Test in 1973, it was, because by then, they and I had become pretty good friends. I'd written about them right in their early days. The formation of this band roughly coincided with the first edition of Time Out magazine in 1968, which I co-founded with a guy called Tony Elliott, and I was the sort of music correspondent for the magazine, and wrote about this band in very, very early days. Subsequently, they became friends of mine, actually, and appeared on my Sounds of the 70s radio programs before arriving in the Whistle Test studio in 1973. And I'm sure when you see them, you'll agree with me that they look like the definitive progressive rock band. This is Argent.
Will you look at that guitar?
It looks as if it's...
I hope it got it cheap. What's it made of?
Swiss cheese.
It's made of cheese. It's a guitar made of cheese.
Can't be right.
Now, that guy is not Colin Blunston, is he? Because they were in the... Rod Argent was in the Zombies.
Rod Argent was the leading light of the Zombies.
And made, let's be honest, Dave, I want this on record, made some fantastic records. Remember She's Not There by the Zombies?
They came from St Albans.
St Albans. Put St Albans on the map.
And they were having huge hits when they were just teenagers, I think. You know, She's Not There, Time of the Season.
Time of the Season. Oh, that's a wonderful
song. And then he went off.
He went off, and this is it Ross Ballard?
That, I think, is Ross Ballard.
Ross Ballard, indeed.
On the
another feather cut.
And I think we're going to go for the full set.
Well, Rod Argent.
Rob Henrit, oh, yeah. I think, on the drums. I may be wrong. And Jim Rodford on the bass.
Can I just ask you, how do you know that?
Well, all the space in my brain that I didn't take up learning foreign languages and things like that allowed loads of room for me to remember the names of bass players.
Names of the rhythm section of Argent.
Isn't it?
You've stumbled through life having never had any recourse to use that information until now.
Until now, which is, I suppose, yet another reason to thank the DVD.
Sunglasses in the studio, one of the early sightings.
Somebody made an album called Shades in Bed.
Shades in Bed?
It's the record.
I don't think they were referring to sunglasses, though, surely. This is emotional shades, Dave.
It was
sunglasses.
It had a picture of a couple in bed wearing sunglasses.
It would have been Ian Hunter, someone who couldn't survive without sunglasses.
It was the record.
She'd just sleep wearing them.
And I think somebody else made an album called Sunglasses After Dark.
Sunglasses After Dark, possibly. Rod Argent on the left there is wearing the most sensible. I think what we used to call a big girl's blouse in the 70s. It's got kind of ruched sleeves, doesn't it? Sensational hair.
That's the Three Musketeers hair, isn't it?
It is.
And Rod Argent went on to produce very successfully. Produced Tanita Tikaram's big hits. And produced Nancy Griffith. I met him once at a session for Nancy Griffith, not him. That's Ross Ballard.
Ross Ballard also had a huge amount of success, didn't he?
I'm trying to think. The other Argent hits, Hold Your Head Up.
Hold Your Head Up.
Hi.
Oh, yeah, I thought you were going to sing it for a minute. They were sort of massive, glam kind of influenced pop songs. What was Bob saying on there about the prog rock thing?
I take issue with Sir Bob's theory that this is progressive. I don't think it's wildly progressive. I think this was sort of a bit Mott the Hoople influenced.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I think
proper prog, if we're going to have this conversation, proper prog involved, every song had to have about three or four different movements.
Sections.
One had to have an acoustic guitar, which I think this does, actually. It had to have a 9/8 time signature, didn't it?
Here we go. There you go.
Oh, yeah, here is the acoustic. Well, okay, that's defeated that little theory. Okay. But they also had to have one of those solos, or several, actually, by the kind of, basically said, I'm classically trained. I went to the Royal College of Music. I learned a lot of Bach. And there's Bach fugues. Remember
the classic case of this is Yes, isn't it? And Fragile. Yeah. When Rick Wakeman joined Yes, they started doing this. Didn't, and the whole second side of the album was into sections. You know?
Oh, yeah. Well, Soft Machine made a double album, which only had four tracks on it. And if you do the math, that means one track per side. And each track was like 25 minutes long. Yeah. And had about 19 different time signatures. I can remember going to see a group called Clemen Pool, a little kind of glam rock prog band in Chelsea in the mid-70s. And they played, not unlike this actually, they played Bach's Bourée. Do you remember that? Which Jethro Tull did as well, do you remember?
Yeah,
it was on their second album. Jethro Tull did Bach's Bourée. And they played it in that kind of really slapdash, I've kind of basically learned a bit of this. And I'm going to play it on this very easy action, very loud guitar to give the impression that I'm a musical genius. And I'm going to play another song about me and my girlfriend and how my thoughts are like confetti. And and how, war is a really bad thing. And peace is great. And, beer should be cheaper. And, and I'm walking down Portobello, flying a cotton aeroplane. There's the cheese guitar again. Look, he's got his cheese guitar back. Guitar made of cheese. Let's just hope he didn't pay a lot for that. Because that would be terrible. What happens after about 3 days? It would just kind of go off. You couldn't play it anymore. But this is it's kind of stadium rock rather than prog, isn't it?
Yep.
This builds up to the massive anthemic chorus.
What's going
chorus.
On there? What's that strange business?
I don't know. Who's that guy? That's the you remember his name, don't you?
Jim Rodford.
Right, well, that's part of the stage act, which the, modest size of the Old Grey Whistle Test studio cannot contain. They've broken out. That is a pair of dungarees. I'm sorry, from where I'm perched, those are dungarees.
I think that T-shirt might well have a Rupert Bear logo on it. If his bib were to fall down, we would see it.
Almost certainly. And that's a medallion.
There's a lot of chest itch going on here, isn't there?
no one's playing that guitar.
Absolutely.
Now,
he was
nobody,
playing the rhythm part. Maybe.
Nobody played that guitar lick. So this is either not... Actually, it's live, but they've got overdubs.
Sergeant, and God gave rock and roll to you.
Yeah, that first time on Whistle Test was a bit of a shock for us. Walking into the studio and finding out just how small it was. It looked a lot bigger on television. Being a live band as well, finding that we couldn't play live, we'd have to mime to a track was not really what we wanted to do, but we were there to do the show, and we got on with it, and we were very happy doing that because it was our first TV appearance, and it really meant a lot to us, first album and all of that kind of stuff. So I still can't remember. It is a long time ago, though. It's 30 years, I believe. I can't remember if we were miming the vocals as well, and I've looked at the tape, and sometimes I think, well, yeah, maybe we are, and maybe we aren't. I don't know. It's up to you to decide. It was a great experience and a great moment for us, and on a special show.
I always like this guy. Do you remember Pick Up the Pieces?
I do. Which is from the second album. I mean, this is the record they make for MCA, which got loads of really good reviews and didn't sell. But then after that, they went to Atlantic and they really sold. Now, Hamish Stewart Hamish Stewart, who was talking a minute ago, you're about to see the most astonishing contrast in a man's hairstyle that I think has ever been. There he is! Look at that!
That is
the man who was just talking about.
The man destined, in fact, to go on and sing the John Lennon parts in the Beatles song that McCartney played, because he was in McCartney's band for quite a long time, wasn't he? Really good singer.
Very good musician.
Really good musician. And I would say that he is possibly singing live, but they are not playing live. This drummer, later on, there's a fantastic clip of this drummer where he is not actually touching the kit. Because these guys were live musicians, as you said. I mean, they weren't used to mining. And so, you know, there's great art in mining. And there were groups in the, you know, mid-80s, you know, late 80s, who in fact made a profession out of, you know, basically out of miming, very good at miming, to tracks that they didn't play, were probably actually recorded by the Blockheads or something. You know.
So sadly, Robbie McIntosh, who's the drummer here, died.
He died in some
heroin.
He did.
Overdose at a Hollywood party on their first tour of the States.
Which presumably completely scuttled the group, because in the group
were on the
ascendant.
They got Steve Ferrone in as drummer. That happened during the campaign around the second album with Pick Up the Pieces and Got the Love and all those things. But I mean, they were one of those groups. You know, the name's a bit of a strange one in the sense that, you know, people genuinely used to listen to them and couldn't believe that they were white.
But that was the irony, wasn't it? It was like calling a band the Beautiful South or something. It was a resistance to the idea that you were just an average white band and that no white musician could have that kind of rhythm.
Hmm. Well, it's the quality of the voices as well. Put it where you want it. Crusaders song. Or Crusaders instrumental originally. They must have done the lyrics for it. Didn't have lyrics originally. Sure, you got that kind of Joe Sample keyboard. That's a lot of hair.
It's a huge amount of hair. I'd say too much. Is it possible to have too much hair? I think it is.
Travis on sax.
Remember the controversy about their albums, AWB. Remember, the W was the naked woman's
behind. It was
a bottom. It was in fact a bottom.
It was a bottom.
Well, that was considered to be very non-PC.
We made our own entertainment.
We did. My, how the long winter nights used to fly by. Put it where you want it.
Symbol on the bass drum there. That was their logo for a while.
Oh, well, that's strange looking.
frankly,
Android or whatever it is.
Gollywog.
Gollywog. Smiley face. Proto's one.
It's one of the things you can't do in rock and roll anymore.
The Average White Band from their new LP, and that was Put It Where You Want It.
One of the restrictions we had to work under during the early 70s was imposed by the Musicians' Union. They insisted that any performances by American bands on British television had to be reciprocated by a British band performing somewhere on American television. Now, we were seemingly much more open to American bands over here than the networks in the States were to British bands performing over there. So it was a problem, not for us, but a problem for the promoters bringing the bands in. One that was successful was a band called Montrose, with Ronnie Montrose on lead guitar and Sammy Hagar on vocals. Now, they were a band that were used to performing fairly heavy-duty stadium gigs, and I think they were slightly shocked when they got into our tiny studio to see the size of it. But nevertheless, the performance they gave was actually a stadium performance, so the cameramen were sometimes in danger of their lives.
Now, I'm a big fan here. I've got this record.
You got this record?
First Montrose album, I loved it. Me and my mate Stuart Hartley, living in the flat, 407 High Road, Wood Green, used to come home and play this record really loud after work. Sammy Hagar.
Sammy Hagar went on to join Van Halen.
Well, oh, okay. Well, yeah, probably did.
He had a group called Hagar, I believe.
Interesting, though, because I think this is the record that invented contemporary heavy metal. Post Led Zeppelin heavy metal was invented by this record. It was produced by a guy called Ted Templeman, who was a genius producer. Produced the Doobie Brothers and Little Feat and Captain Beefheart and loads of people. And they just made this kind of really cranked up, you know, very radio-friendly metal sound, which Van Halen, under the same producer, Ted Templeman, did again, like two years later, I think.
Yeah.
And then, after they'd had all their massive success and David Lee Roth, you know, they squabbled and fell out and whatever, Sammy Hagar may well have been in Van Halen later on.
Yeah, because all this stuff...
This wrote the book, I think.
It had all the best elements of your massive Led Zeppelin heavy metal band, but they were really structured in songs, weren't they? It's verse, chorus. Which ultimately, I suppose, all your, you know, your Guns N' Roses and all those bands were some kind of trading out of, weren't they? All the kind of excessive trim.
Denny Carmassi on the drums.
So you used to sit there staring at the back of that sleeve, didn't you?
I did.
Wood Green.
Bill Church on the bass.
Neighbours banging on the wall.
The one we used to play was Rock Candy. It had the loudest drum intro you've ever heard. It used to remove plaster from our old flat, which is not difficult to do if it's in our old flat. Probably got the first hi-fi for this record.
Yes. In the days, you love that. The days when the bands would go out to kind of, you know, Compass Point or something and spend £10 billion recording this album for months, eating lobster every day, and then, you know, David Hepworth would listen to it on a tiny little bench there with
a bush
speaker about the size of this coffee cup and go, "Wow, listen to that drum sound!"
Yeah, wicked. They came over as part of the Warner Brothers music show.
Oh, yes.
With Little Feet, Doobie Brothers.
That's right. With that wonderful Warner Brothers cartoon on the cover, yeah. What a package.
Here we go. Big finish.
Get on your back,
yes. Knocks over three cameramen. Fine trousers.
And that, of course, Dead Silence. Huge.
One of my favourite Beach Boys songs was Disney Girls, and it's not a Brian Wilson song, although I thought it was for a long time. It was actually written by Bruce Johnson, who you're about to see, and one of the great things about this clip is that the original recording, for people who know the record, is so elaborate and so beautiful and kind of archetypally Beach Boys, and here it is stripped down to a piano and a voice, and it's just so moving and so beautiful, and very typically Old Grey Whistle Test, I think, to have that song appear in that kind of setting.
I was watching the tape this last night. I thought it was kind of like a precursor to Unplugged. Because you know the song, symphonic version of this, and you've heard it a million times on the records. And that's the test of any kind of song, that, you know, it will still work with just one bloke and a grand piano. What's happening with Bob? I told him to keep his head down.
This, I can't get over this. Bob's a bit... This is sort of...
Bob's
classic,
asleep.
Classic whistle test awkwardness.
Bob's gone to sleep.
Somebody said, we'll have Bob in the back of the shot. And so it's very difficult for Bob, because what are you supposed to do? Look at the camera. No. So
tap an appreciative toe.
And so after a while, it looks as if you'd nodded off.
The man really looks like he's looking at the inside of his lid. Oh, reality. Keep that noise down, Mr. Johnson. Presenter's having a kip.
So this is on Surf's Up, isn't it, the song?
Is it?
Yes, it is.
I think so. Bruce Johnson, if I remember, was... Because he was involved with the whole surf scene, wasn't he, in about 1962, and wrote Do the Surf Stomp.
Did
he? Is that right? Yeah. Oh, he started writing some surf songs, and then he met the Beach Boys, I think, in a studio, and I'm pretty sure when Brian Wilson decided he wasn't going to tour anymore, which would have been
about 65, he went on tour
instead. He became the kind of Brian Wilson replacement, really. He was meant to be the great moderator in the group. Carl Wilson died, and you had to decide which you were going with. Mike Love's Beach Boys or Al Jardine's Beach Boys. But both of which, I have to say, is quite a long way removed from Devil, Deep Blue Sea.
Rock, Hard Place.
No need to decide, except there was.
Bob.
Bob. Bob. Come on, Bob. He's fast asleep, isn't he? Bob, 30 seconds to go. No, he'd had a late night. He'd been out with the Argent. And those clear stars. How good is this song? Sorry, this is a great song.
Interesting pop fact. Bruce Johnson, I actually found this last night, wrote the songs for Barry Manilow. Isn't that odd?
Barry Manilow
singing a song called I Wrote the Songs.
Which he didn't write.
But then
it's kind of odd. Totally surprised. Because, you know, Barry Manilow does, if he does nothing else, Dave, he radiates authenticity, integrity. I'm sorry it's come as such a shock. No, actually, it is a bit rich, let's be honest. It's a rum old do, isn't it? Okay, it really is absolutely out for the count now, look. You're going to see a technician come on and tap him on the shoulder a bit.
He'll tiptoe out the studio.
Bob, Montrose are back. They're the next track. What great voices these guys have. Very hard to be in the Beach Boys and get them to do one of your songs. I was just saying to Brian Wilson, do you know what? I've written a song. I think it should be on the record. Because there's no sense of competition there, is there? Did you know that I spent the night with my dreams of you? And the warmth I missed, and for all those things that I wished for, now they're all come true. I've got some love to give and a little place to live. I guess I'm gonna stay. It'd be a perfect life. Why would he be never playing this song? Which is interesting, isn't he? I don't remember he had a solo album at the time, really.
Don't know. Could have done.
Oh, we'd all have some early nights. And some this is the kind of thing the program did very well.
Mm-hmm. He's obviously going to
get the Bob Harris interrogation afterwards, isn't he? Because he's going to go to that chair.
Oh, there's a chair waiting for him.
It's the mastermind chair.
Warm cushion. Do you remember that you're allowed to smoke in those days on TV? Bob, you used to actually smoke cigarettes.
First time I ever went in the Whistle Test studio.
People actually smoked on air.
You couldn't see for smoke.
It seemed phenomenally exciting at the time. Didn't need dry eyes. It's just Bob with 20 Rothmans. And then Montrose would come on. Like Peter Cook, the famous Peter Cook interview, when he went to say, "How are you?" and he said, "Who are you?" to his guest. Apparently, it went very, very badly. That is good, isn't it? Isn't that worth having? I may listen to that again on DVD without me quacking over the top of it.
Disney Girls.
I remember Bebop Deluxe's first appearance on Whistle Test, not just because it was our first appearance on Whistle Test, but because it was also our first television appearance ever, and we were all very, very nervous, particularly myself. And I can remember watching the countdown on the studio clock as it came up to the broadcast time, and of course everything was live and there was no opportunity to retake anything should anything go wrong. And I was aware that at the other side of the camera was a huge audience scrutinizing everything we did. And whilst I was used to playing in front of a lot of people in a concert situation, the TV thing was an awful lot different. And there was a lot of trepidation, a lot of nerves. And as soon as we started playing, we also had to deal with the fact that the kind of sound that we had wasn't quite the same as the sound we would have on stage. Things had to be kept to a much quieter level. So there was a sense of feeling constrained in some ways, but despite that, I thoroughly enjoyed the whole thing. And at the end of the evening, when we'd finished the second number, the whole band were kind of initiated into this television performance lark, as it were.
Bebop Deluxe came from Wakefield, which is where I went to school. So, always close to my heart.
I always felt that they were... and there was a whole raft of those groups, like, you know, Bees Make Honey and the Tyler Gang and Chilli Willy, all those pub rock bands with immense pretensions who were just sort of wiped out by, to some extent, by the arrival of punk rock.
Well, they were, weeks later. These guys were a big signing for EMI. They spent a lot of money on these records. And this is from the second one, I think this was. It's called Sunburst Finish.
Touch of eyeliner, by the way, viewers. I think you're fine.
Just a bit.
I think those eyelashes have received some form of attention as well.
That won't go unremarked in Wakefield.
Well, no, Wakefield. I went down well in Wakefield. So he used to wander around Wakefield looking like that, did he, Dave? Don't think so.
And
let him into Waitrose looking like that.
And they were kind of what record companies used to call a priority act. Until punk came along and EMI had the Sex Pistols and suddenly had other fish to fry. Charlie Tumahai on bass, sporting a bit of a bowler hat.
Good singers, though, these guys.
Now, what he was talking about was they used to have a noise meter in the studio.
It's called a limiter. Was it called a limiter?
It was just something that they used to stick near the amps, the technicians. This was provided by the BBC to make sure you weren't playing too loud. Because if you're playing too loud, you might impair the hearing of the blokes in cardigans.
And there was that famous time, wasn't it? Not on the Whistle Test, but on, I think it was the Late Show.
The Late
or something
Show
with
the
Stone
Roses.
When they played about six chords, went over the limiter and all the power.
And everything. It used to cut out all the power in the studio. So it's pretty serious if it happened.
You can understand the feeling of restraint that these guys suffered from.
So the guys used to do, the bands would do the run-through. And then, in between the run-through and the performance, they would move the limiter thing.
And I remember seeing David Bowie on the programme, and he was really an exciting thing to see. And I hadn't, you know, I'd heard his records, being about sort of 14 or 15 or something, I'd heard his records, but I'd never really seen him, you know. And to suddenly see what it was all about, I thought, hey, this is exciting. This guy's really got something. Yeah, this is good. I like this. How could I do something like this? Better take up the guitar. No, I'll stick with the piano. Oh, well, there you go. Anyway, so, I mean, I think it would seeing people like that, who you hadn't seen, it would often inspire you to want to either be like them or buy their record or whatever, you know, which is a very good thing. I remember seeing, and there were people who since have been maybe not thought about so much. I remember seeing somebody called Judy Sill on there, and I thought she was charming. Played sort of an acoustic guitar, really nice chords. I wasn't quite sure what it was all about, but I went out and bought it. But realised, again, it was going to be rather hard to learn to play the guitar at this late stage when I was taken to the piano. So, again, destined for disappointment as far as copying people was concerned. I suppose I remember seeing Nils Lofgren, and he had a brilliant pianist with him. I mean, that was the thing at the time as well. I was sort of 14, 15, and Glenn Tilbrook, I started playing with him, he was in Squeeze, and he was a great guitarist. And we'd both watch a show and talk about what we'd seen, you know, and people who we liked. But of course, being a pianist, I was interested in seeing piano players, but there weren't really that many. It was a lot of people with guitars. And I love the guitar, but, you know, I was always happy when I saw a piano on a whistle test.
And indeed, the pianist that Jules Holland talked about in that link on this track, of course, is Nils Lofgren.
Fantastic, this. I love this.
He's so good.
The solo he plays in the middle of this, I'm prepared to say, is one of the great top five keyboard solos in popular music, along with Alan Price out of House of the Rising Sun.
Alan Price, House of the Rising Sun. I'm not going to argue with that, because I can't actually off the top of my head think of three better keyboard solos.
But I saw Nils Lofgren again recently. Oh, he's still playing with Bruce Springsteen, and he still looks unbelievably cool.
Yeah, he does, even when wearing a gigantic pantomime, you know, Stetson hat that he was required to wear. Do you remember at one stage? They did this whole thing about trying to get themselves recognised in the back of the stadium, and he still looks fantastic. Great looking. In a kind of Keith Richards style, egg timer face, you know.
You see, he's still pretty young here. He started incredibly young and played with Neil Young and After the Gold Rush and so forth, and with Crazy Horse, and then with Grin.
And made all those absolutely fantastic solo albums. Do you remember?
Well, this is the. This
remember,
is the
I came to dance, and well, was this, it 1979?
That was the
one Steal
this.
Away.
This is the best one. This the just called Nils Lofgren, and he made it with just three people, just himself and Ainsley Dunbar on the drums, Warnell Jones on the bass, and it's mainly piano. And this is one of the great tracks, Carole King.
This is a Carole King, a Goffin King song, isn't it?
It's just Carole King, I think. But it's just drives along. It's so light. The touch in it is so light.
It was a fantastic version of this by the Birds. Yeah. The Birds version.
But not as good as this. Here he goes.
Reverential silence in our commentary boxes.
Well, I love this. I'm playing it.
He's sort of miming Neil's solo.
I taught him this.
Taught him all he knew. Rare moment where the whistle cast cameras are actually missing the key moment of a solo.
Absolutely.
I've gone to the wrong instrument.
Here he goes. Twiddly bit. Camera's not causing it. That's his brother on bass. That's Tommy Lofgren.
I'm trying to imagine the young Jules Holland sitting at home watching this. It's a lovely image, isn't it? And he's right, because you very rarely saw piano players.
Good drummer.
You're not seeing this one. You're seeing the drummer.
This is live. This is proper live, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's the only shame they couldn't accommodate his trampoline jumps, which always used to be a great
that was the
highlight
late
of Nils 70s. Lofgren.
Nils Lofgren, for those who didn't see it, Nils is also one of the smallest people ever invented.
He's
about, what, 5'3"?
Oh, yeah.
And he used to do this solo act where he would...
Well, he was a teenage
put his guitar
gymnastics
down.
Champion.
No wonder he'd get away with that. I remember seeing the Hammersmith Odeon. In fact, with his guitar, he would jump off the stage onto a little tiny trampoline. Let's call it a trampet. A mini trampoline.
They secrete and execute behind an amp.
A perfect little arc. Yeah. Backwards while still playing guitar.
Triple salco.
And you've got to give him some points for that. There can't be.
Absolutely.
You know, in the world of trampolining rock stars, I imagine he's probably ahead by a country mile, wouldn't you? Not a competition.
I love Nils Lofgren.
I do too. And a very underrated singer. Yeah. Really beautiful,
soft,
deft sound. When he sings, when Bruce Springsteen and that full team step up to the microphone, Patti Schiaffa and him and Miami's Steve Van Zandt, it's a beautiful combination of voices. Another great wearer of the sunglasses, the rock and roll sunglasses. Oh, we like that. They're going wild in the commentary booth. More Nils, we're saying.
Hello, I'm the real Bob Harris, and this is the real Old Grey Whistle Test.
About 2 years ago, we had a hit in America with this song off an album called Abandoned Luncheonette, and it's called She's Gone.
I have a bit of an audience here, you see. Is this from a kind of in concert or something like that?
This is not done in the studio.
These occasional things.
This is not done in the studio. You can tell actually later on in this disc when it starts in the studio. I think it's in the early 80s or whatever. People like Tom Verlaine are actually playing to an audience. But this is obviously at a concert, isn't it? Would it be? Yeah, it would start in sound.
Yeah, maybe not sight and sound. They used to do these whistle testing concert specials occasionally. This is.
And let's be honest, it made a difference.
Oh, yes.
A little bit of warmth coming off this. You know, these guys also probably kind of six numbers into the set rather than having to go from a cold standing start, crank up to their new hit single or whatever.
Yeah, you used to stand in front of these groups sometimes at the beginning of the programme. You know, the classic link at the beginning would be come out of the old Star Kicker or whatever, and there you would be standing in front of this group who were about to have to, you know, just play, you know, to nobody. And sometimes they were kind of shaking with nerves, you know, the terror of doing it.
And you didn't feel much better yourself.
No. It was live, you know.
Oh, well, yeah. Where was it? I think we did, it was 2.7 million people watching every Tuesday night. You remember that?
Was it really that many?
Yeah. And I can remember getting a link wrong, just kind of just drying, basically, in a theatrical way, just forgetting what I was going to say. And Andy Kershaw launching himself from behind the sofa and just knocking me onto the floor to somehow diffuse the agony of this moment, for which I've been eternally grateful.
So, Hall & Oates, from Philadelphia. When Daryl Hall was only about 16, he was singing as a backup singer with people like the Stylistics and the Delphonics. He was, you know, proper singer. Didn't just learn it all later. It's one of my wife's favourite records. It's off the album Abandoned Luncheonette.
It's a brilliant record. That's a great favourite record too. Beautiful sleeve. I love the way they used to sing in octaves.
Thing you started to notice here in the late 70s is the arrival of the straw hat. We've traced various tonsorial trends here.
I don't want to interject this, but I think the arrival of straw hat usually was connected with the slight receding of the hair.
This is just what I was going to say, because you started to get musicians who were slightly older, and therefore tonsorial fallout was an issue.
Well, do you remember Mike Love and the Beach Boys? The more Mike hair Love. He used to lose, the more he used to open up his shirt.
Because he had he
actually looked like a gorilla. And in the end, he took his whole shirt off and wore a turban.
And wore a turban.
He wore a turban.
I remember it clearly.
What are we talking about, Mike Love? We were watching Paul and Oates.
No, because we're talking about this bass player cove or guitarist or whatever he is wearing the old white straw hat.
So what happened with these guys? Because these were great
records. I think they're back together.
I think.
And they were managed by the legendary Tommy Mottola.
Oh, yeah.
He was not the most popular man in the record business.
But a very good manager.
A very good manager. But I remember once Rolling Stone magazine did a big feature about Hall & Oates and it was a little bit of an edgy feature, which is fairly unusual for Rolling Stone.
Oh, the headline was the Self-Righteous Brothers.
The headline was the Self-Righteous
Brothers. Oh, I remember it,
Which I thought was a great headline.
I've always wanted to use their headline myself in a magazine. I'm sure there must be some more candidates. Yeah, they took themselves very seriously, and I think that particular piece, which I remember, was an attempt to prick the bubble, wasn't it?
Of course, John Oates, a man who could stand shoulder to shoulder with Nils Lofgren in the smallest people ever invented category of rock and roll. Small guy.
With Prince and Kylie Minogue.
You could pop him in your top pocket.
I sincerely hope you're not listening to this, actually.
Good song.
If I'd had a pound for every time I saw the words Hall and Oates in the same sentence as the words Blue-Eyed Soul,
yes,
I'd have nearly 15 quid, Dave. That would have been in just 1 year. That was the cliche, wasn't
it?
Blue-Eyed white
soul.
Boys playing soul music.
Stanford White Band as well, wasn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. She's gone.
Fine pair of Blairs.
These are fantastic Lionel Blairs. Tony Blairs, they're now called.
You see, this is 3 years after the average white band, but I mean, in terms of presentation,
it's so
moved
slick,
on massively,
so polished.
It is.
It's presentation and
a lot
of that,
isn't it?
Well, you're warming up to the point where what you looked like became so crucial. Well, thank you, the Hammersmith Odeon. We'll leave you with this one. Really makes a difference, doesn't it? Yeah. Seeing people actually perspiring because they're halfway through a set.
Thank you. No. Track 4, side 1, album 3, Joan Armour Trading, Love and Affection.
She would have been told to make an announcement.
No, but there you see in a nutshell why Joan Armour Trading, fabulously talented, never became a big star. Because she could never take it seriously enough. You know what I mean?
Yeah, very self-conscious. and also very kind of self-effacing in interviews.
Absolutely.
She's apologetic.
Absolutely.
She made these great records. Now, if she'd gone out in the kind of ballsy
and
R&B
behaved
style,
as if she was Madonna or something.
Yeah, just gone out there and said, basically, I'm fabulous and you better believe it. It might have made a difference. But she used to just come along and said, I'm awfully sorry. Can I bother you for a second? I've written these songs. Which were fantastic.
This is from her great record. Joan Armour Trading, the third album, which is just a wonderful record. Now, fact fans, Jerry Donahue in the background there on the guitar. Jerry Donahue played the Fairport Convention of various people.
Oh, yes. Oh, she had several.
And I think it's Dave Mattis.
Dave Mattis probably in this clip. Dave Mattis certainly played drums with her for a while. As he played drums, I remember Dave Mattis on All Great Whistle Test in a band with Nick Haywood of Haircut 100. Do you remember? They was with everybody.
They used to keep Dave Mattis in a cupboard.
He basically had a cupboard. They'd let him out every Tuesday. Who have I got this time? You got Fish from Marillion. Oh, excellent. In my eyes and the red
on my face. It's a big hit, this one.
I'd like to think that her music had some kind of long-term influence. I'm sure it did.
It's nobody plays it anymore, which is
no, I don't think you hear it. I don't think you hear it on the radio. But there was a whole era of, well, certainly your Tracy Chapman, I think, looked like Giorgio Bobbitt.
That's Dave Mattox. It is Dave Mattox. Dave Mattox. I claim 5 points. That's
excellent.
Dave Mattox. I think the best player is Dave Marquis.
Who was Dave Markey?
Just the bass player of Joan Armour Trading.
Oh, right. I thought you were going to lead on to something. The great Dave Markey.
Jerry Donahue on the left, formerly a member of the Poet and the One-Man Band. If you want to get really obscure. Canadian. Because she used to write these songs with this woman, Pam Nestor, didn't she?
Now, I'll tell you what, they met. You know where they met? You know where they met?
Go on.
They met in a performance of Hair,
oh,
the musical, in the late 70s. Now, what amazes me is why haven't we seen any pictures of that? Because Pam Nasta, who was a lyricist, right? Yeah. And Joan Armatrading were in the chorus line of Hair.
Joan Armatrading.
Shaftesbury Avenue.
Not have been in the chorus line of Hair.
I think she was.
Was she really?
Yeah, she performed in that show. And I'd love to know where the photographs are. And that's how they met. And they went on to write songs together. So I love that, you know, that this is these wonderful, sensitive, introspective songs. Preceded by somebody, you know, in a pair of gold hot pants leaping about a Shaftesbury Avenue stage. You gotta start somewhere.
Who's that saying?
Now, that, how 70s is that? A three-piece white suit with no shirt.
So Joan Armatrading, like so many of her generation, has been able to knock out a good version of Good Morning Starshine at the drop of a hat.
One of the great things about the Whistle Test was it was never frightened to show a musician's eccentricity, and such an artist was Roy Harper, who was completely off his trolley. Lovely guy, great friend. When I was with Straws, we supported Roy on a nationwide tour of the UK, and when we arrived at the Fairfield Halls in Croydon, and this was in 1970, it was right in the midst of the World Cup. And Straws, we'd played our first half and had gone pretty well. And we love Roy and a lot of his songs, and so we decided to sit in the audience and watch him do his half. And he came on, I think helped by a few, shall we say, additives, and sat on his stool and picked up his guitar, and he had the huge long hair and the beard, and sort of played a couple of notes, then adjusted the mic and went, England are playing Argentina tonight. It's on the telly. And put his guitar down and walked off and went and watched it. And the whole audience went home and watched it.
Roy Harper, where do you begin, Mark?
This is Roy Harper in his Vivian Stanshall stage, you see. There's a sort of facial similarity. I used to love this man.
I know.
And I think he kind of arrived at that precise moment which would have had a devastating effect on the musicians involved when the degree of fame you got was so far removed from the amount of success in financial terms. You know, you could be, to quite a prescribed area of the landscape, a huge star, but only sell probably about 10 or 15,000 records. On
one
10 records.
One of them was to you.
One of them was to me. I used to love this man, go and see all his concerts. And for a brief period of my life, I wanted to look like Roy looked on the gatefold sleeve of Flat Baroque and Berserk. Where he had the longest hair and a big old beard. He looked like the sage, seer and prophet.
What are they? Roy Harper, whether you like him or not, great album titles.
Oh,
Come Out Fighting Genghis Smith.
Flashes from the Archives of Oblivion. I mean, how 70s is that? Stuff. Isn't it wonderful?
That's the one where he's pictured
naked.
When an old cricketer leaves the crease is one of the greatest records ever made.
No,
I'm not a big Roy Harper fan, but I love When an Old Cricketer Leaves the Crease, which is dedicated to Jon Snow and Geoffrey Boycott, who were both kind of retired, I think, around about that time from playing. This, I'm not sure what album this is from, but it's the one that's also got... I've got to be rather careful here what I say. It's got a song that he had to withdraw from the album.
Oh, why not?
Because of legal action from a catering chain.
About food.
At a well-known motorway service area.
Yeah.
He wrote the song that had been on the mind of many musicians.
This is in the days where you could get Waldorf salad and croutons.
And he wrote this song and then had to withdraw it from later versions of the album.
Yeah. The great story about Roy Harper, do you remember at the time, was that he actually had... probably still has a blood circulation problem, and he used to have terrible nosebleeds and strange things that made performing quite difficult. And to excuse his non-appearance, his very, very imaginative PR put out the story. Do you remember? He lived on a farm.
Oh, the sheep!
The sheep! And he had these sheep. And the story was that Roy had somehow given mouth-to-mouth resuscitation to a dying sheep and had contracted a very, very rare form of probably bubonic lung disease. And you were told, well, why isn't Roy playing the, you know, the Bracknell Sports Centre? I've paid my £2, you know, what it was, 20, 2 and 6, in fact. And that was the Roy had apparently got a sheep disease. And for many years, people believed this. And I think it did him quite a lot of good. People thought, wow, what a very altruistic individual. I always thought he was rather, you know what I mean?
Been saving the wild life of a sheep.
Saving the life of a sheep. I'm sorry he can't be here.
Do you know there's a Beatles connection with this song?
What's the Beatles collection?
That Paul and Linda did backing vocals on them.
They're on the album, they're credited.
I'm not sure whether they're credited, but they're rumoured to have, you know, thrown in their backing vocal on this track on the album.
You're looking at me. I will have to go back.
I think you'll
what I'm annoyed about is that you're on my turf here.
Absolutely.
Paul and Linda
and
Roy Harper, and the fact that I don't know this.
Yeah, yeah.
Another... Roy notices, refused to wear. Why is there a T-shirt, by the way, with the word bull on it?
He made an album called Bull in a Ming Vase.
Bull in a Ming Vase, maybe. Roy is not wearing, as you notice here, an old grey Whistle Test badge. He's wearing what I think...
is the Queen.
...is the Queen. He's wearing a... possibly in an ironic way, Dave. I don't know. I may be wrong.
I think probably we were the most surprised of anyone that we ended up on Whistle Test. Punk had been going for at least a year... And it seemed like it was never going to catch up with punk rock, and we seriously get a reputation of being stuck in the 70s. And in the end, we ended up on it somehow by default. A member of Blood, Sweat and Tears had died or killed himself, and they had to pull out of the programme at the last minute. We were on tour in Ireland, and our drummer, original drummer, Laurie Driver, caught hepatitis. And was hospitalised, and we'd just gone into rehearsal. We'd been in rehearsal, I think, a day, 2 days, when we got a call about this tragedy with Blood, Sweat and Tears, and would we come on and be the first punk band on Whistle Test, which, of course, was really exciting. Much as we were cynical about the programme, we, you know, really wanted to come and do it. And before we knew it, we were heading up the motorway to Birmingham because Whistle Test was being unusually filmed at Pebble Mill, which was also... funny, because that was where the really conservative Rich and Judy type lunchtime show was going out at the time. So we sped up there and set up our gear with all the proper musicians, and were able to be the first punk band on.
Well, as you may have read in the Radio Times, Blood, Sweat and Tears were due to appear on tonight's show, but as you probably heard, their saxophonist Gregory Herbert died in Amsterdam last week, and the band has cancelled its British tour. The adverts have kindly agreed at short notice to join us instead tonight. They are led by T.V. Smith, who is emerging as really one of the most imaginative and strongest writers of the new wave. Next week, the first adverts album, Crossing the Red Sea, is released, and the band are going to play three tracks from it, kicking off with Bored Teenagers.
At last, the 1978 show.
So what,
there's fighting talk.
Oh, all political. What a little irony that it takes the death of one of the members of the old school to let the new school on the programme. That's a bit rich, isn't it? Can I say, I watched this last night, and Dave, what was the key thing about the adverts? It's not a difficult question. What was the one thing of paramount importance about the adverts?
This is the most ridiculous case of missing the point I've ever seen.
The point of the adverts was, let's be honest, two words, gay advert. Now, Gaeva was playing the bass on the left.
She's not even in shot.
You know, you see her at one point, and it was immensely exciting at the time.
Because all the blokes,
raven-haired vixen,
all
was playing the bass.
Who read The Enemy and bought sounds and so forth, they all fancied Gay advert like Max.
Something
was,
criminal.
You know.
And you do see her in about 30 seconds of time as a shot between the cymbals, where they're probably actually focusing on a particularly complicated
there
piece
she is.
Of drum. But there she is. You can just see the top of her head.
Gay, over here.
And she had brilliant hair makeup, didn't she? Eye makeup.
Concentrating rather hard on that bass.
She is, actually. Probably only bought it yesterday.
There's a possibly apocryphal tale told about the sales manager of a...
there she is, Gay advert. Look. Wearing the Whistle Test badge.
Of a record company who were charged with promoting an advert single somewhat early on in their career. Stood up in front of the entire sales force and said,
sort of special incentive. Those who can do the biggest selling on the new advert single get to sleep with Gay Advert. Those were the days. I don't think this was ever delivered, but it was the idea that you could even make that claim.
See, now actually, you'd probably be all over the papers.
You would be.
They'd lock you up, David, and throw away the key.
Good group, though. Do you like them?
Made one really good album. Crossing the Red Sea
with the Red Sea with the Advert.
Yeah. New Church. Tracks for
the second album.
Trust me. Was that the second album?
When I was 17, when punk rock first started kicking in about 76, 77, I was hungry for any kind of information on punk I could get. And initially, the three weekly news music papers that we had at the time in the UK were not exactly reluctant, but reticent perhaps, to cover the punk rock scene. You had Sounds, NME and Melody Maker. And whenever there was any punk rock, any old punk on TV, I get fairly excited. So I can remember seeing things on the Whistle Test, like the adverts with Gay Advert on bass and TV Smith on vocals, doing Bored Teenagers. I particularly like the American groups. I remember the Talking Heads. I think they did Psycho Killer. And I can also remember any New York groups I loved. I remember Patti Smith doing the song she co-wrote with Bruce Springsteen, Because the Night.
It's a strange kind of co-writing, this, because the story goes that Jimmy Iovine was the engineer on Bruce Springsteen's sessions at the time when he'd first written and recorded this, and he played a version of it to Patti Smith, who then added some words of her own and so had her version out before Bruce Springsteen's. So it's more identified with her than it is with him.
She had a big hit with it, didn't she?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
But, I mean, it's a joint writing credit, though, isn't it?
Yes, but it's just that they wrote it completely separately, I think. Lenny Kaye on guitar. This is the original Patti Smith group, isn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
Who were a huge deal at the time, weren't they? Well, this is the time of television and Talking Heads.
Well, there was a whole interesting, Talking Heads. Yeah, the whole East Coast rock and roll scene appeared to dominate the world. And I was working for New Musical Express at the time. And you had nothing but uncritical adulation for these people.
Yeah. Well, also, they made such good copy, didn't they? I mean, in case of Patti Smith, she was always doing outrageous things and providing perfect quotes for people all the time.
She certainly didn't let me down at the Q Magazine Awards. I can remember organising the show for Q a few years ago and decided I wanted Patti. Patti had won an award, I think, and we'd done everything we could to get her to come over, and I got Polly Harvey to come on and present this award. And Polly Harvey was terrified.
Yeah.
She's quite a shy individual. And even more terrified, of course, to be in the presence of somebody she genuinely adored. This is the person who got her out of bed in the morning every day and caused her to be a musician. And, you know, she got me this speech. And Patti Smith had rounded on her, these pale imitators, you know, rounded on the event, rounded on everybody, the food, I think she went through, the quality of the waiting service. It was a disaster.
She's not one for seeing the funny side.
No, she's not.
You can't sort of go to Patti and go, never mind, say pop music.
Don't need pop music. Keep the balloon in the air. Keep it all moving.
Moving
just
along.
A bit of fun. A little bit of entertainment. It's how we put food on the table, Patti. We're all trying to make a living. No, I think she took it pretty seriously.
Is that the second bowler of the programme this evening?
It certainly is. Yeah.
Two bowlers. Yeah. Two bowlers.
It's a movement.
Straw hat.
It's virtually a movement.
A feather cut. What's going on with the trouser department here, Patti?
Culottes. Would that be the word?
Oh, I don't think... might be.
Huge collection of badges. Again, very New York. Wish we could have a close-up.
There was a period around the time of the punk thing, about 1977, where the Old Grey Whistle Test, I think, kind of became something of an anachronism. You know, it was still felt slightly behind the times with all this stuff that was happening in the NME and everywhere, the Sex Pistols and the Clash. And
It really caught up again for me when they had Susie and the Banshees on. I think they just signed their record deals towards the end of 1978. And it just brought it bang up to date. It was just such a fantastic sound. It was just such a harsh kind of modern sound, something that you didn't associate with the old Grey Whistle Test, and she just looks great too, and there's nothing wrong with a bit of glamour and pop music.
Around a year ago, the entrance to almost every record company in London was aerosoled with the command, sign the Banshees, do it now. In fact, no one did for a long time, but significantly, as soon as Susie was committed to vinyl, they had more or less instant success. Their first album will be out next Monday, and it's entitled The Scream. They're here with us tonight to play two tracks from it. Firstly, Metal Postcard, Susie and the Banshees.
Intermediary period in the old Grey Whistle Test history here. They moved out of the studio into Shepparton, I think it was.
Oh, yes.
A huge, great venue, which actually had not actually a live audience, but just basically a load of record company pluggers.
People hanging about.
With bottles of beer in their hands. But there were people hanging about. And I remember going down there as an NME reporter to write about The Damned being on the programme, which is very exciting because the programme had just discovered punk rock. And watching them on the programme where they were destroying equipment and behaving like they normally behaved at the Vortex.
And there's, of course, bigger studios now.
Yeah.
So you get more movement.
But it made a lot of difference to the feeling of the broadcast. This just seems a lot livelier and more authentic somehow. You know what I mean? A lot of the people just stuck in a room with a load of technicians.
You a big Susie fan?
I can't say I'm an enormous Susie fan, but I can just remember at the NME how they're a very, very good copy. There was some bizarre tale involving probably these two guys, actually. I think that's Steve Severin on the bass. This is before Budgie joined, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So I think the drummer was Kenny Morris.
Yeah.
And the other guy, I think he's a guy called John McKeag.
John McKay,
was it. And those guys left the band in the middle of a tour in about 1978. They just left. They ran away from the Banshees. That's actually what happened. And I'm not exaggerating. They left in their beds in the hotel. They left pillows and clothing to give the impression it was their own sleeping bodies to give them slightly longer to make good their escape. Now, all I'm saying is, what was life like in the Banshees if you had to literally knot the sheets together? Climb out of a back window together. And they brought in, honestly, they brought in Robert Smith of The Cure, came and played bass to finish the tour. And the drummer was Budgie, who probably still is the drummer, in fact.
They were on tour in Scotland, weren't they?
They were
supposed to go to a record shop signing or something, and they didn't turn up when they were back to the hotel.
But I thought it was very funny because, in a way, you had to treat it as being a major rock and roll story, but it couldn't be less rock and roll somehow. It's just these two blokes just thinking, well, sod this, I'm going to go and get a job in a bank.
Is this off The Scream? Is this off the first album? I think it is, isn't
it? I think it is, what you're saying? Yeah.
This is, what is it? Metal Postcard. This is inspired, it tells you everything about Susie and Banshees. It's inspired by the work of a German artist called John Hartfield, who used to do metal propaganda postcards in the Nazi era.
Which, of course, was very fashionable, punk groups at the time.
What?
Wasn't it? Just invoking any kind of Nazi, what's the word? Memorabilia.
Well, this is anti-Nazi, this was. But, They definitely had that dark side.
Yeah.
See, another great sex symbol of her era, Susie, along with Gay Abbott.
Yeah, I was in a pub the other day. They had all Ray Stevenson's old photographs of her in her kind of, wearing her kind of bodice.
Right.
And,
Dominatrix.
Dominatrix look. Major sex symbol. Now lives in France.
Yeah.
All right, south of France.
I think so, yes.
Occasionally reforms the band, does a little tour. Still lives with Budgie, the drummer that replaced the geezer in the right.
That ran away.
kind of ran away. She all worked out in the end, though. Happy days. But this was a very significant appearance on the television at the time.
I suppose so. You see, all these groups did it in the end, didn't they? They just sort of had to look a bit unwilling.
Yeah, I don't think any of them were that resistant, no, deep down, to reach an audience like this, but you had to look like you were horrified by being in the same room that had once been occupied by Mountain.
This is really good.
This is a strange one. This is really good, isn't it? I was surprised by this. I don't remember.
I don't remember it at all. But this is so live. You listen to the sound. He's already broken the guitar on the left. guitar string, rather. The sound is so live. Scott Gorham, who's standing just to the left of Phil Lynott now with the long hair, his guitar actually isn't plugged in. They only plug it in at the end. The poor guy's cranking away. But the live sound is...
Oh, he's got his badge on the...
He's got his badge on the machine heads.
A bit of an innovation.
And this is a Phil Lynott song, of course, isn't it?
Well, it's a Thin Lizzy song, surely, isn't it? I mean, that's what I'm trying to work out. With Thin Lizzy kind of in... Are they given up at this point? And Phil Lynott had gone solo and Gary Moore had this And Friends set up.
I guess so, although everybody playing, apart from I think Cozy Powell, I think, is playing the drums. You're going to see him in a minute. The rest of all, we've all been members of Thin Lizzy.
Yeah.
Tough nut, Gary Moore. You think Scottish, you know, barroom bruiser, don't you think? I've got 3 minutes left with only 5 strings. It's a bad feeling, isn't it?
So this must have gone out live, otherwise they'd have stopped and gone back. We just had to carry on.
It's pretty
good, isn't it?
You never notice.
Like a jam, doesn't it, really?
Yeah, yeah.
But it worked.
There's a keyboard, which you can hardly hear as well. Just a very loud bass guitar.
Well, Phil Lynott no longer with us, and Cozy Powell no longer with us.
I had a very strange experience flying up to London to Tyne Tees once to go. There was a program called Razzmatazz, and the two groups on that program were a reformed Phil Lynott. This was about 18 months before his
reformed
death.
Thin Lizzy, rather.
Reformed Phil Lynott. That'd be good. Did that ever happen? And Musical Youth. So on one side of me, I've got the 8-year-old keyboard player from Musical Youth, and the other side I've got Phil Lynott, and they're both on the same programme. You remember. And Lynott ordered a large Scotch and Coke, and they gave him a Scotch and Coke with two little tiny miniatures of whiskey. And he said, I'll have a really large one, thanks. And they gave him another Coke with two more whiskies. And when the waitress came back down the aisle, not 30 seconds later, he said, make that one more, by which he meant same again. So he finished it with 8 miniatures.
In the morning.
Actually, it was early afternoon, to be fair. But I've got the 8-year-old Musical Youth keyboard player on my left with his eyes standing out on stalks, you know. God bless the boy.
Now
do you remember? And Leslie Crowther was his father-in-law.
His father-in-law.
He asked Leslie Crowther for his daughter's hand in marriage, and what did she say, Dave? She said, "You might as well. You've had every other barber."
Exact.
He did.
Well, they've plugged Scott in now.
You can hear him now.
I used to like Thin Lizzy.
They're really, really good.
Another group ripe for revival.
They had a real head of steam at one point, didn't they?
I was a great fan of this kind of so-called heads down, no-nonsense, mindless boogie. Like this guy.
And Scott Gorham looked like a proper rock star. Let's be honest, he's an American, isn't he?
It's such a boy's fantasy.
Yeah, no, totally a boy's fantasy.
Gary Moore with a broken guitar string, and Don't Believe a Word, and before that, Back on the Streets. Accompanied, I'm sure you noticed, by that up-and-coming young vocalist Phil Lynott, Scott Gorham, also from Thin Lizzy, Cozy Throttle Powell, and Don Airey.
That's Jimmy Jamel!
That's great!
Now, you're looking at a bunch of men here who've never known the stylist experience, have they, at all? Right?
Somebody wrote a great piece about them at the time, I remember, in The Enemy, I think, saying that the telltale, the trademark sign of the Undertones was the trousers that were a little bit too short.
Yep.
As if they were trousers being handed down by, you know, an older brother and you'd already grown out of.
Yeah.
I thought that was a really good observation. In fact, you know, the sleeves on their shirts always looked to be a little bit... They just looked like they were kind of permanent adolescents. And, of course, the Undertones are reforming, but without a significant member of the group, Dave. And which one is it?
I think it's the singer,
Mark. It can't be the singer, can
it's
it?
It's the singer.
They're reforming without the singer.
Fergal Sharkey, one of the most distinctive rock and roll voices, and probably the most distinctive voice in punk.
Certainly
which
was
not known for fantastic singers. Yeah. He was a great natural singer.
And so if somebody told you that REM were reforming without Michael Stipe, or Blondie were reforming, it's the same thing, isn't it? In principle.
It doesn't really
work. It is one of those guys who somehow managed to epitomise every characteristic of the group.
They just looked amazed that they had the success that they did, really. Didn't they?
And they made some fantastic records. I feel like it's really touching that John Peel, quite genuinely, still talks about Teenage Kids being the greatest record he's ever heard in his life.
Mickey Bradley, the bass player.
Oh,
because they're all kind of related one way or another, aren't they?
Yeah, they were sort of extended family, weren't they?
There were three O'Neills, aren't they?
Yeah,
two brothers and a cousin.
Yeah,
or something like that, and another cousin, I think.
Yeah.
Fergal Sharkey, no relation.
No relation at all.
Once went on tour with the Undertones. Went to Leicester.
For which magazine was it?
I think it was just... That's a good question. Smash It, probably.
I was there in their
hotel room when they used to phone in for the chart position on Tuesday morning. It was in the days when you genuinely didn't know where you were going in the chart. Nowadays, everybody knows. You know, so they were dead excited.
Was the sky black with chapeau on that particular occasion?
Yeah, it certainly was.
Furline Parker, ahead of his time.
Millet's finest.
I think Squeeze's first appearance on Whistle Test, we were very excited to be on the programme because we'd seen lots of people on it growing up, you know, and so then to be there in that studio with no set or audience was rather exciting. And the atmosphere was quite quiet, let's say that. And they said, when you do your song, could you do an announcement? And so we took this literally and thought we'd better make an announcement. Not of what the next song was, but just an announcement. So I announced that there was a car in the car park blocking the way and its registration number was Pen 15. Pen 15, which we all thought was really funny and howled with laughter, but was greeted with silence from the rest of the studio and probably in television land as well.
Oh, there's just been a message sent in from the reception with the owner of the blue Ford Cortina, registration number PEN1S. Please go to the reception as he's blocking a fire exit. Thank you so much.
So that was, I mean, I think that was probably our early attempt to inject a little bit of humour into the programme. That wasn't really what it was known for. It was known for having great music on, of course.
Diplomatic link from a man from at one stage a rival network.
No, you always had
Gilson Lavis still. Gilson Lavis playing drums still in the Rhythm and Blues orchestra, isn't he?
Yeah.
They were very good schools.
Chris Difford, Glenn Tilbrook.
There's a whole tradition of that kind of suburban English songwriting, starting with the Kinks and going through the Small Faces and Squeeze and Weller and Blur and Pulp. Don't you think?
Yeah.
Writing with that incredible level of observation about the details of life around you. And this great vocal trademark they had of singing in octaves. Chris Difford on the left sang the low part. And Glenn Tilbrook on the right there sang an octave above him.
A little bit of musical analysis. That's very good.
Don't piss him nodding off. You can't blame him. And so the rest of the list. Moving on.
Harry Kukulé on bass.
I had to go through this
whole tape just naming bass players. That ought to be my specialist subject, wouldn't it?
That would be as thrilling, possibly, as my comments about the octave intervals of the vocal lines.
Is this from their first album?
I think so, yeah. I love Jules Holland's kind of theatricality that he used to put into it. You know. That kind of music hall thing, which you've probably still got some of those.
Yeah.
He actually used to come on genuinely with that lighted cigar.
Yes.
Gilson Davis. So I remember interviewing them at the time, and they'd just been out to Australia and all hated apart from Gilson. And Gilson's highlight was being driven down
a main strip by a beach somewhere in New South Wales, at 80 miles an hour, holding onto the roof rack of the car. I don't know who was driving, probably another member of Squeeze. And he thought this was an excellent way to spend his time. A real tearaway. He was on top of the car, holding onto this roof rack, being driven at 80 miles an hour. And he told me about it, and I published this piece of information in the New Musical Express with a great degree of relish. I thought it was quite funny.
Sounds like another Australian sporting first, doesn't it?
It is a thing, yeah. It's car
sales. That become a national event.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good skinny tie there.
Very good.
Has anybody got the jacket sleeves, you know, rolled back, which was a big fashion at the time, isn't it?
Glenn certainly used to go for that. That became absolutely de rigueur, the linen jacket.
Yes.
Phil Collins was the one, and Mike Reed, the DJ, always had a linen jacket with the old sleeves shoved up. Which gave the impression that, A, I'm wealthy enough to buy an expensive suit, and B, I'm so wealthy I don't even care about
mistreating
it. Exactly.
It's very difficult for somebody to convincingly play an instrument with a cigarette or a cigar in their mouth, isn't it, don't you think? They always look as if they're desperately worried about they're going to drop it.
They're going to choke.
Like Ronnie Wood, you know, it never looked right to me.
But he has to do it, though, because if he's not doing it, he's not Ronnie Wood.
Yes,
it's actually in his contract.
Back.
You read the small print in Ronnie Wood's contract, as she says, he can only enter the stage with
Wood,
a lighted cigarette.
Mr. Wood will wear
yes,
a cigarette.
The party
of
the first part must smoke constantly, which is a huge problem for the man. Although Chris's guitar's got these little tiny slogans written on it. Which is the really early days when they were a kind of slightly punky pop band from Deptford.
Oh, look at this.
Jules relegated to just playing strange ambient chords on a synthesizer. The keyboard action, I think you'll find, Dave, is happening on the right. He's nodded off. And who can blame?
Orchestral Manoeuvres in the Dark come from Liverpool and were first recorded on Tony Wilson's excellent Factory label. Since then, they've been signed to Dindisc, who put out Electricity and Red Frame White Light as singles. Now comes the first album and their first studio appearance on Whistletest. I'm delighted to introduce you to Paul Humphreys on keyboards, Andy McCluskey on bass, with Dave Hughes also on keyboards, and Malcolm Holmes on drums. I was also going to be very delighted to introduce you to Winston, the four-track TIAC star member of the band, but apparently he's gone to the great recording studio in the sky. Orchestral Manoeuvres.
I'm reminded watching that, it's always really difficult to compose these little links that you used to use to introduce these groups, because they were standing behind you at the time you did it. Particularly at the rehearsal, they were standing behind you.
And which made it even more embarrassing. No, because if you used the same link that you used in rehearsal, then you felt, you know, that even though they'd rehearsed, we're doing exactly what they'd done in rehearsal, you felt a bit sort of...
Fraudulent.
Fraudulent. I can remember Andy introducing Elvis Costello in the Attractions, and he was just terrified. And Elvis coming up behind him, for some reason, putting an enormous crown on his head. Do you remember they had a crown on stage?
Was the King of America.
Yeah, it just threw him badly.
But there was once this... Mike Appleton, the producer, rang me up and said, we've got this girl, Annabelle Lamb, on. And I said, who's she? And he said, well, she's got a new album on A&M and blah, blah, blah. And anyway, I said, well, you better send me a biog if I'm supposed to say something to introduce her. And I don't know, you know, most people haven't had a lot of experience of reading record company biogs, but usually they're three pages of utter twaddle. Just kind of...
Hard-gigging Glaswegian quartet.
Yeah. Just garbage and compound adjectives and, you know, nonsense and... After ages in the studio doing demos, they finally got a deal and all this kind of stuff. And the only interesting fact in this biog was that Annabelle Lamb had previously been a nurse. Okay.
Oh, I remember this. You
now,
said
call
so.
Me
you said
dumb.
It, yeah.
Call me dumb, but I think that's the kind of thing that people just think it's vaguely interesting. Yeah? So I did a little link to introduce her in the run-through.
I remember, and you were manhandled out of the studio.
Not
half Nelson by a load of managers.
I was taken aside between the... Between the run-through and the thing, by the guys from the record company said, Annabelle's not happy about what you said.
She was never a nurse, right?
I said, what? What was she not happy about?
It just didn't happen.
Didn't like you mentioning being the nurse. You know, and it's just, in the end, you had nothing to say at all other than, you know, her record is coming out on A&M and its catalogue number
which
is
was entirely what she wanted to say in the first
day.
It's available at all good record shops.
Yeah.
OMD, incidentally. Do you remember they used to have little ads in the back of the New Musical Express in the late 70s for something called Bowie pegs? It was a type of trouser that tapered very neatly to the ankle.
There we
but
go.
It was capacious at the top. I think you know where this is leading.
Yeah.
Our boy, Andy McCluskey. And Andy McCluskey, incidentally, of course, is the man behind Atomic Kitten. Now, the guy playing the bass guitar there at the microphone writes all the music.
He's a mogul now, isn't he? He's invented Atomic Kitten.
And he also, or Tony Wilson, very famously told him not to dance on stage. But I think they're one of those groups where if you were tethered to a series of keyboards, they felt obliged to put on some kind of theatrical show.
Shall I tell you how outside the normal show business tradition orchestra manoeuvres were? I once saw them on stage, and they were very late coming on. Well, here we go, jazz funk, I suppose.
So Stanley Clarke. Oh, look at
Oh, Stanley!
Keyboards. Stanley Clarke. Stanley Clarke worked, didn't he, with all those band leaders, Stan Getz, Chick Corea.
Yes, I suppose so. Yes, he was a regular on that kind of circuit. And bizarrely enough,
Dexter Gordon, Art Blakey, all those.
Well,
guys.
Probably. I mean, he'd be a younger generation than most of those. I'm trying to remember. He just had this really big solo album, just called Stanley Clarke. Well, not really big, but you know, moderately big for a bloke who played the bass guitar, which is not normally seen as an instrument that will make your fortune for you. And then he subsequently teamed up with, there you go, George Duke.
That's our boy on the right there, isn't it?
Now, George here is presenting his solution to the age-old piano players.
Precisely what orchestral manoeuvres were struggling with before.
Which is, here
how can
I
you
am.
Make keyboard playing visually interesting? The answer is take your keyboard with you.
I refuse to be stranded behind this hostess trolley.
Yeah, while everyone else is out there impressing women in the front row.
So
I'm stuck here, exactly.
So I'm going to design. Away. I'm going to design this, frankly, rather grotesque thing, which I'm going to carry around with me. And all the girls out in the audience are going, "Oh, George, I never knew you were, you know, such a charismatic figure."
That's right.
I see you in an entirely new light now. Gone away again.
He's gone away. So Stanley Clarke also formed the. Are they called the Stanley Clarke Project?
They could have been. No, this was called the Stanley Clarke George Duke Project.
Oh, right, but anything with the word project in always rather worries me.
Yes.
Duran Duran had a side group once called Arcadia, it was called, and they called that. It was known as the Arcadia Project.
Oh, yeah.
Once it because of project, it's worrying, like it is a bit. It's like the shine goes off.
Like a school project.
A school project. It's something rather hard work, doesn't
you
it?
Have to
it's a bit challenging.
You have to submit it before the Easter holidays. It gets marked.
That's right. It's going to get marked out of 10.
You get sent back.
George Duke, see me. Could do better. But Stanley Clarke obviously wanted to be in this group in order for it to be a Stanley Clarke vehicle, which is fair enough.
You're that guy.
This guy is fantastic. I mean, he started this whole, this superstar bass player thing that was carried on by, I don't know who, Jaco Pastorius, etc. But he's playing the bass in a minute as a melody instrument, isn't he? He actually starts to play a bass solo, which, and viewers, this may be stressful, it lasts for a long time. He plays a bass solo as a lead instrument, plays little melodies, doesn't he? But that old gag about the natives in the jungle.
Oh, Mark King once told me this.
Oh, it was Mark King telling you it.
And I couldn't possibly do it justice, the way Mark King told it. Mark King of Level 42, who is one of the funniest men in popular music. You know, he could actually stand up, be a stand-up comedian. Genuinely really good at it. And it's just some story about, you know, a musician goes on holiday to Africa and is in a hotel. And all the time you can hear the drums.
Distant drums. Yeah.
And he ends up having a conversation with the waiter in the hotel about this. He says, you only have to worry when the drums stop. And the whole joke is, why, what happens when the drums stop? Oh, it's terrible when the drums stop. Why, what happens? He says, oh, it's awful when the drums stop. What happens? He says, bass solo.
Why is that still so funny? I've heard that hundreds of times. Bass showcase. But anyway, that's what we're going through now.
Let's do the jokes about musicians.
Musicians. Oh,
what's the one about? What do you call a man who hangs about with musicians?
A drummer.
That's so mean, isn't it? You wouldn't feel very pleased, would you?
I know. Actually, most drummers know that joke and accept it. They tell it themselves.
Yeah.
Stanley Clarke. There we go. Where have we got to? Going back to the less portable keyboard.
Yeah. A lot of wandering around went on in this group, didn't it?
Musically as well.
So I'm going over here to play this, and maybe sometime.
Still something in my adolescent self that's breathlessly impressed by somebody able to play one instrument while holding another. Going back to Rick Wakeman again.
Three keyboards.
You should say to people, he's three times as good as, you know, your guy, as Vincent Crane from Atomic Rooster. He only got one. He's going to do that. He pressed a little bit above the fret that day, which had bent the string. Again, you're perfectly at liberty to tell me to button it. I'm boring you to tears. And I accept that.
That's quite nice.
It is. There was a brief period of time, though, when this music was everywhere. This music was the soundtrack, wasn't it? You remember?
I think
you go into bars, you go to
something. I think some of this is coming back.
Probably is. And the kind of Crusaders were part of that as well.
Oh, Crusaders still sound good. Crusaders just reformed recently. Really good record.
I think there's probably a bit of an appetite for this kind of thing at the moment. Because it, whether you like it or not, it's genuine people genuinely playing instruments.
Oh, absolutely.
It's not kind of just come through a desk. You know?
Yeah.
It's not being flown in, is it?
Yeah, when some kind of you know, prowess as a musician was applauded rather than
be people.
That's what I loved about
the
punk rock bands or the old Great Whistle Test in the late 70s, you know, that some of those guys were actually quite good musicians, but had to try very hard to pretend not to be, you know, trying to unlearn everything that they'd memorised at music school. Or he's enjoying it anyway.
You see that? I can do that.
You just don't feel like
it. Can't be bothered. This sort of thing has been forever spoilt for subsequent generations by... what's it called on the Fast show? The
jazz club.
Yeah.
Nice. That isn't a jazz club. It has, actually. You're right, and that extends to this. I mean, it's any kind of self-indulgence, isn't it?
Hey, here comes George.
Back to back a minute.
Not to say rare pleasure to introduce our studio guest tonight, Tom Verlaine. Like so many artists of the late 70s, he was found, if you like, at the New York club CBGB's with the band Television. Their first and acclaimed album, Marquee Moon, was released in 77, but they broke up a year later. Tom went solo, released two of his own albums, and last year toured America for the first time under his own name. His third album, which is quite superb, is Words from the Front, and is released here now. And the man himself is here for the first time in 5 years. Please welcome Tom Verlaine.
Now, one doesn't wish to be ungentlemanly.
You're going to talk about Annie's frock, aren't you?
Well, Annie's top.
Top. It looked theatrical. It looked like she'd done one of those kind of some juggling act outside of Covent Garden.
going to be
followed by trying to break out of an ice cube in mime.
So this is 1982. Does that indicate that sort of new romanticism was,
thinking. Sorry,
it looks a bit like that, doesn't it?
It does. She's been to heaven. Remember heaven? Under the... Well, I didn't see you down there very often. under the arches at Charing Cross. Tomberlane. Tomberlane, they made some fantastic records. Can I just say, Marquee Moon is a wonderful record.
It is.
Foxhole, a single, wonderful. Adventure. And I last saw him with Patti Smith Group when they played the Shepherd's Bush Empire. And he was the guitarist about 2-3 years ago. And he came on the stage wearing a straw hat and put a folding chair down at the front of the stage and performed in the entire evening sitting in a folding chair. At the end, got up, bowed, folded up his folding chair, went off stage. I thought, well, none of us getting any younger. But no, it was good. It's a really good performance.
Mike Appleton, who used to be, was the grey eminence behind this, the whole Whistle Test empire, otherwise known as Biggles. Quite why, I never quite worked out. But anyway, Mike, lovely guy, but the vaguest man in rock.
Oh, without a doubt. If you ever mentioned the name of a band to Mike, he'd always go, did we once have a game called It's on the Tip of My Tongue?
I was going
to... We actually started a quiz show.
I used to spend a lot of time on aeroplanes with Mike, going to interview bands, and you'd sit there, and Mike would try to think of a name of a group, and he'd go, well, we had this group on the programme once, and that's about as far as he could get.
And you'd how many of them were there?
Any girls? Black or white?
What sort of instruments?
You know,
were they American, were they English?
And then about 5 minutes later, I'd go, you're thinking of the Enid. And he's going,
the Eagle.
That's brilliant. And so I wanted to have this quiz show called, or game show called, It's on the Tip of My Tongue.
And every week where you'd people have star would come, Mike Appleton. And you'd have to mention the group.
No, you'd just get members of the public would come along and face a bunch of experts and they'd go, I saw a film once.
Yeah, yeah.
And people
and the buzzer would go.
People would tell them what it was.
Yeah, that's right, same seconds. As the Yardbirds. Haven't finished. Dock 5 points for interruption.
And that was the Mike Appleton format, you know, because he couldn't remember the name of anybody apart from possibly the Beatles.
What I liked most about Mike was his the lack of enthusiasm he had for discussing work. And you went on aeroplanes. I used to travel on trains with Mike. I'm a great train enthusiast, as is he. And Mike and I would travel to the out of London dates on the train. We'd set off early. And I'd say, where are we going to sit, Mike? Imagine it would be the second class. No, it'd be the restaurant car. And he would flag down the finest table. And we'd sit there with a little bit of poached halibut, pushing it around a plate, followed by fine Chablis. I'd be going, but Mike, I've got to introduce the Smiths in a minute. You know, I'm just trying to get an idea for a link. You know, do you want me to give you something? No, old boy. Oh, no points at all. Then he'd tell a couple of fantastic stories about the Jimi Hendrix experience, and he'd be there, and he'd arrive, half drunk, reeking of garlic. Oh, he's excellent. And remains so. It's lovely to see him interviewed in this DVD. There should be more of Mike.
Yes.
Where's the more of Mike? Yes. There was a wonderful commentary on the first...
We ought to interview thing. Mike.
We should interview Mike. We should let's do a DVD 4. Which is the background story to Old Grey Whistle Test. It's the Appleton profile.
It's all these mysterious figures that probably really hardcore Whistle Test viewers, and we know really hardcore Whistle Test viewers because they all run off licences, don't they?
Oh, yeah. You walk into an office. To this day, if I go to an off licence and it's a bloke, you know, with one of those small TV sets just perched on the counter in the, you know, unlikely event that the shop will be empty and he'll be bored. Brackets, which it is most of the time. Closed brackets, and he is. And they're watching Old Grey Whistle. They used to watch Old Grey Whistle.
Absolutely.
And reruns.
Yeah. So anyway, what was I going to say? Yeah, and you used to get these names on the credits. You know, people used to wonder who they were. There's a splendid lady called Alma Player.
Alma Player.
And Alma's lovely, but I think it's fair to say not the world's biggest rock expert.
No. Well, you went off to interview Mick Jagger once. And she said, "Lovey, would you like a press release?" Do you remember that? That was so great.
Would you like a biog?
Yes. Again, hard-working South London five-piece.
When we made a record called Walk Out to Winter, we cut a kind of almost a disco version with a guy called Tony Mansfield, who was a great record producer in the 80s. And we used one of the first Fairlight synthesizers, which were one of the first ones in England. And I remember we took it to a rehearsal studio and a heavy metal band on their way out spat on it. And we brought it to the Old Grey Whistle Test studios and people were so kind of taken with this new piece of technology that the camera men wanted to do a special shot of it to start the song, like it was more important than the band.
And that was kind of prophetic in a way for the 80s, that the equipment became more important than the bands. But I just remember our clip started with a shot of the Fairlight and then went to the band. And it was just really interesting. It was kind of like when Brian Eno turned up with his Moog synthesizer in the 70s, I suppose.
I think that's very well observed by Roddy there. Who, let's face it, must be about 24 by now, mustn't he, Roddy Frame?
Well, I can tell you how old he is in this clip. That's the one thing you all knew about Roddy Frame, that he was incredibly young.
It's amazing.
In point of fact, he was probably older than George Harrison was in the Beatles. Yeah. But in fact, I'll tell you how old he was. In this clip, he was 18. Right?
Really?
Yeah, he was 18 years old. And he'd been going some time, and you'd try and interview him and sort of say, when can we fix the time? They say, well, you know, he's got to be back at 11 o'clock.
His mum's picking him up.
Yeah, he's got to finish his GCSE, he's got to do his homework. He's only eight.
That's right. He was good, though.
Oh, really good?
Really good record. No, but it's well spotted, that business about the Fairlight, because you can just imagine Tom Corcoran, who is the legendary director of Whistle Test, legendary fishing hat-wearing, bearded director, was always fascinated by technology.
Of course he was, absolutely.
And so you'd turn up to do a programme and say, we've got so-and-so in, and do you know, they've got an amazing machine.
Well, we had a piece on Whistle Test in the, I don't know, probably 1984 or something like that, where it was about technology, and it was around the time of a machine called the Synclavier.
Oh,
remember that? Synclavier was basically an emulator. You know, you could drop a milk bottle and record the sound of the milk bottle dropping, and then turn that into a pitch and play it as a C chord or an A minor. And we actually had a piece on the programme where we all gathered around. I mean, it must look like something out of, you know, Tomorrow's World.
Absolutely.
They'll probably dig it up in about 50 years' time, you know, do it in black and white. Chumley Warner. It's Chumley Warner. Hello, what's this extraordinary thing here? Do you mean to say you don't need anyone to play drums anymore? It could all be done by this machine. Good Lord, people will be out of work.
Do you remember the brief period, though? Round about the time we were doing Whistle Test, there were suddenly these advances with instruments, and you started to get the drums. Has he got some of those drums there?
Oh, syndrums.
Syndrums.
Syndrums, yeah.
Terrible things.
Yeah,
didn't syndrums look like drums at all.
No, they were like little pads. They were pad drums, you know.
And then you started to get basses that didn't have machine heads.
No machine heads at the top. Didn't look real.
And it didn't look real. It's
not
really
proper.
Interesting, because everybody adopted them for about a year. Spandau Ballet, I remember particularly, adopted them. And then they all went away.
They all went away again.
Because there was a genuine, yeah, there was a realisation one morning, this doesn't look like rock and roll anymore. Let's go back and get the guitar.
Can I just say, this is a fantastic solo. We just missed it. We just missed the solo. There's another one later on. Really good musician, this guy.
Yeah.
Playing a really good card. Sorry, Dave, it's going to be boring. Very complicated semi-acoustic guitar. It's very hard to play. Very difficult action. Really good. And, I hope he's still making some money out of it.
He still makes good records.
Yes, he does. He's still going.
I think I introduced this show.
This show came from
somewhere in the middle.
Oh, I was going to say came from the Riverside Studios.
Oh, actually, okay.
Because that was another intermediary period in Riverside, where there was a live audience. Another great solo. Look,
he's good.
And they used to just, about 400 or 500 people would shuffle in, not knowing what they got tickets to the Old Grey Whistle Test, but they wouldn't know what acts. They'd be going, I hope it's so and so.
Good evening. On tonight's programme, we've got The Pretenders, John Cougar Mellencamp, Eichtodsender Neubauten and The Europeans.
We're also going to be wildly frogging around the disco charts, but first, here in the studio, it's Thomas Dolby and Hyperactive.
You still got that shirt?
Those guys haven't changed at all, have they? It's amazing.
They still look exactly like...
You see those guys in the street, whoever they are. They look exactly the same. It's phenomenal. Such preservation.
Eichtodsender
Neubauten. I had to pronounce
the
that.
The amount of pronunciation.
Do you remember? We've been counted in, and I had about, 30 seconds, fairly high level tuition, actually, to make sure I got that right. Thomas Dolby, very good. Designer Macintosh, a la David Bowie.
Thomas Dolby, not his real name.
Probably not.
No.
Real name was?
Called Dolby because he was an electronics genius.
Ah.
He used to make his own PAs. And things, so they just took to calling him Thomas Dobley.
He's called us Dobley. That'd be called David Diode.
This is Adele Bertai on singing with him.
Oh, right.
She made a wreck on her own.
Yes, she did, yeah. That's a very 80s look in the background. The guy with the area.
There she is.
That's her. The guy on the left in the white shirt with the red braces.
Yeah.
She's really good, that film.
Now, you're talking about that business of people turning up in studio audiences and not knowing who they were going to get. There was... John...
Pete Toms?
No.
What's his name?
John Duprez, who played with Modern Romance and...
Yeah, he was a member of Landscape, that guy. I think he's called Pete Toms. I may be wrong. Okay. Move on.
Keep it moving. And I once went to see a Tom Waits in concert at the BBC Television Theatre. And in those days, you just used to apply centrally to the BBC for tickets to see a show.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And
so you could have there got was a Jim coach party. Or,
yeah. There was a coach party of elderly people who had clearly come expecting Jim will fix it or Wogan. And on shuffles Tom Waits.
Let me introduce you to another nocturnal.
The powerful aroma of salt and vinegar crisps coming off the auditorium.
And these
the soft tutting of very disappointed people. I want to see Terry Wogan or something.
We did a show. It was unfair to both of them.
Oh, well, Whistletest did a show in Hitchin Theatre in Hartford when the Spandau Ballet when they were number one. And it was somehow wrongly billed as a live concert, the Spandau Ballet. Now, they had the number one record. Was it true? Was it? You
something like that, yeah.
And therefore, 700 or 800 people had arrived expecting to see Spandau Ballet for 45 minutes. Or for an hour and a half, in fact. And what they got was one song from Spandau Ballet, and then me and you, I think, and Andy. So going, well, we'll be seeing Spandau Ballet a little bit later in the programme, and now here's a load of videos you probably don't want to see by Robert Palmer. And it was so dangerous in rehearsal that we were given, I am not exaggerating, we were there, actually, we were given bodyguards to get us through the crowd to make sure that the Spandau Ballet fans did not rip us limb from limb. I'm really a bit aggrieved about that, having a word with Mike. It's all right for you, mate. You don't have to go out there on stage. My life's in danger. Thomas Dolby led the group that David Bowie used to play Live Aid. Do you remember that?
Oh, right.
Because the Whistle Test team were brought in to present Live Aid,
yeah.
Which is very exciting at the time because, of course, normally it would have been the preserve of the BBC Two boffins. But they thought, no, this is rock music. Let's get our rock guys. Send the crack A squad. So in we went. And, and David Bowie had a scratch band. He rang up Thomas Dolby and said, get me a group. And they were really good. They had Kevin Armstrong on the guitar and Matthew Seligman on the bass. Really thrilling for those guys. You can imagine.
What, now, what's going on there? What do we call this?
Oh, God, I don't know. Is that a vocoder? I'm out of adept now. Fair amount of electronic trickery.
He looks like John Oates on the guitar.
It's our boy again. He was the kind of... He was the kind of session trombone. If you ever need a trombone, it's that guy. And I think he was a member of Landscape. I may be completely wrong. In the same way as if you wanted a violin player, you always got the guy from the Fabulous Poodles.
And if you want a pedal steel player, you always get B.J. Cole.
B.J. Cole, still out there. Prog rock saying, prog rock, one of the trademarks of prog was to have a little tiny ripple from some classical gem. And suddenly we got straight to the Starcastle. I feel really confused now. This is a good song. Although my theory about Starcastle was that they were the wings of Paul Weller's career.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because McCartney had three careers. He had the Beatles, he had Wings, he had Paul McCartney. There were many, many Beatles fans. There were many, many Paul McCartney fans. I'm never sure there were any Wings fans. They liked them, although but they weren't fans. You know, I mean, they went
he
to
always
concerts.
Claims that there are Wings fans, actually, and he may be right.
He may be right, but I always felt that with this. I'm probably completely wrong, but Paul Weller, there were Jam fans, there were Paul Weller fans, but Starcastle, they kind of went along dutifully, just waiting for it to evolve into the next thing. Merton Mick, of course.
Merton Mick out the Merton Parkers.
Merton Parkers playing the keyboard on the left there. And DC Lee, Paul's wife at the time, is the vocalist.
Now, there's an interesting shirt arrangement she's got. That's very of its time, isn't it? With the low slung belt and the,
oh, yeah.
All that.
It is.
Looks as if he's come straight in off the golf links, doesn't he?
That sports casual look that he's so carefully tried to contrive. It's paying off. I think they made some good records, Starcastle. Long Hot Summer, very good record. Dave's got a bit quiet, viewers. In fact, Dave's left the room. I'll have put this on record. David Hepworth's not the world's most 100% committed Paul Weller fan. But there we are.
See, these people have been around so long, haven't they? That's they have. That interesting, interesting fact. The punk generation, if you can talk about any such generation,
have now been going
long. Their kind of message at the time they came along was, get out of our way, you've all been here too long. And they've now been here far longer than the people that they cleared out.
Well,
the way.
Yeah, I mean, Weller's been going for
25 years,
which is longer, four times the recording career of the Beatles, which was, what, 7.5 years?
Something like that.
Yeah.
Because nothing makes anything else disappear nowadays, does it? It just joins what's already there. More and more of it all the time.
Well, it's also just this just huge, great universe of sound which can accommodate anything else. So where do you get that jumper from? Weller. Central London. Probably was Carnaby Street.
No,
probably had a charge account.
Ted Baker. He's given it plenty, isn't he?
I think we gave it better for money, don't we?
Yeah.
Even David Hepworth, people, has now drawn himself up to his full height and is frogging furiously around the studio in a manner suggestive of enjoyment.
You got a glimpse of the odd titles there, didn't you?
I think we see those titles there. You mean the
revamped Metal Man?
Metal Man. Whistle Test changed from being Old Grey Whistle Test to Whistle Test in an attempt to try and remain contemporary. Yeah, fair enough. And they put in these new titles, which I thought were terribly funny. And of course, they appear at the end of this disc, and they still make me break out in a feverish sweat because I feel I'm about to be on a live program in about 30 seconds. And there he is, the Metal Man. Do you remember? You still got the star kicker at the end.
So you still had the old Stone Fox Chase SIG tune,
yeah.
But it was rendered via synthesizer.
Well, in the same way as the Martini Ads tune was eventually done by Syn Clavier. Originally it was done by... Do you remember? Any time, any place, anywhere.
Really?
Oh, yeah. So Whistle Test moved forward into the 20th century.
That's the thing I've discovered in my brief dabbling in television, that what television regards as a major overhaul is you change the titles and you get a new sofa. Yeah? Nothing
right.
goes any deeper than that in television.
Yeah.
Nobody ever sits down and says, what are we trying to do and how are we doing it? They just say, we're going for a revolution here. We've changed the titles. And then we fire the presenter.
Fire the presenter. Quite rightly in our case. I used to love Suzanne Vega. I went and made a special, actually, for...
Did you?
A little interview with her in New York around the time of Luca. Do you remember Luca?
Oh, well, come on. And something happened to you in a pavement cafe. It's just coming back to me.
Oh, God, no, yeah. That's right. So I'm interviewing... I was interviewing Suzanne Vega outside in New York. And in New York, people are pretty cool, actually, and they don't tend to bother famous people. And Suzanne Vega was a big star at the time. And suddenly this guy comes lurching across the road through our massive security, pushing sound recordists out the way and said... Can I get your autograph? And she moved forward to get her pen out. And it was me. They wanted my autograph.
Because they thought you were Paul McCartney.
They thought I was a member of the Beatles. And I think I probably didn't want to disappoint the guy and sort of said, okay, this one's for Auntie Flo. Meet my friend Suzanne Vega.
So is this from her first album?
Yeah, I think it is, yeah.
And she had... This is when Luca was a hit. Is that right?
Luca, which was very controversial. Do you remember that?
Yes,
song about domestic violence in the flat next door. A really fantastic song. But I like this. And also, I think it's a throwback to the old, the old Whistle Test of the 1970s. It's got a singer-songwriter.
Yeah.
It's quite a nice mix when a group like this came on.
Yeah.
Alongside all the other stuff. She's really good, I think. Really, really underrated.
Made some great records later on. I mean, still making good records now, though. Changing, Berlin watches from the wall. Her mocking smile says it all as she records the rise and fall. But, American groups could come over and do the Whistle Test and do a few interviews and just see it would really help them at home, strangely enough,
Well, there was always that thing
their profile.
Yeah, and also that the British press were the hardest to please, and if you could conquer the British press, the British press approved of you, it had incredible international value.
Now, I'm too young to remember the skiffle boom of the 50s, but some of my more, excuse me, mature BBC colleagues, hello Richard, had their lives transformed by skiffle, and the unofficial professor of British skiffle is John Walters. John, it seems like it doesn't need a lot of expensive equipment to be able to play the stuff.
No.
And you're now going to show me that it also doesn't need a lot of technical ability.
Yeah, well,
and you have one or two friends already assembled for this.
Yeah, well, luckily for you, it doesn't require any musical ability. All it really is real access music, you see, sort of down-home party music. You see, all you need for the rhythm is one of your mother's old washboards,
right?
Your mother's old thimbles to do that with. Your mother's old tea chest, not played by your mother, as you'll notice. Mother's old jug there. Now, if your mother's got an old guitar, that's what... Do you play the guitar?
Not at all.
Nothing to unlearn, then. You'll be just right for pure skiffle. Now, I've chalked a chord on there. There's a place for you to put your fingers.
There.
Yeah, just give us a chord. There's a mother's old plectrum. That'll do there.
Mother's old plectrum.
One, two...
Three, four. I was in Peel's house, Peel Acres in Stowmarket recently, where he played an old skiffle song. 3 o'clock in the morning, I was staying the night there. And he put on Lonnie Donegan's Frankie and Johnny.
Yeah. In a sense, you know, put it on, and the old lower lip started to wobble, and the eyes filled up, and practically burst into tears. Ron Newton playing the jug. Ah, wonderful to see Walters.
Yeah. Walters with a washboard. Walters produced Peel's Progress for many years at the BBC.
He's into his stride now.
And he was
Peel has ever looked slightly embarrassed by the way. Got quite sure what I'm doing here, he said. Ron Newton, you've got to admit, if you're going to play this.
Oh, well, there we are.
This last night, and the exquisite ambience of Paddy McAloon's wonderful song is very slightly disturbed, eagle-eyed viewers, by a technician running across the stage.
Really?
I can't see if we can spot him about the red t-shirt. I'm quite sure.
Was it a road crew?
I don't know what it was. Something had fallen over, or a plug had come out or something. This is an absolutely fantastic song by a really, really,
really
extraordinarily talented songwriter. With a very good group who had the appalling handicap of their lives, but called Prefab Sprout. I think genuinely did them some harm. It's like that group, The. You know,
certain names you can't have.
And this can't be called Prefab Sprout.
Now, this is from their... is it first album or second? I'm not sure. It came out under the name of Steve McQueen in the UK.
Yeah.
But then they couldn't put it out under that name in the States because... I don't know if Steve McQueen was still alive at the time. But you couldn't have somebody's name because of the legal repercussions.
That's right.
So they had to call it Two Wheels Good.
That's right. I remember talking to them just before they went on, and the girl on the left, whose name I think was Wendy, was the girlfriend of Paddy McAloon, who we're looking at now, who's singing. And I think he just had a domestic.
Get that occasion.
Relations in the band.
Remember the Cocteau Twins?
Were not warm. Oh, my God, yes.
Somebody forgot to put the milk bottles out.
They call the old crow whistle. They're still not
they had
talking.
A tearful spat. In the middle of the run through.
And I thought she was a bit of a pro because she got on. Actually, she does look a little bit downbeat, to be fair.
So wait till
and
I get you home.
And they hadn't quite resolved it. Wait till I get you home. And I think in the bar afterwards they probably kissed and made up. But there was a frosty moment. What a great group. And that's his brother, as you can obviously tell when you see him on the bass guitar. Martin McAloon.
Oh, really?
They look exactly the same. Yeah. And he's made an incredible record recently. He went through this extraordinary thing where he was temporarily blind.
Yeah, he lost his sight.
Lost his sight and therefore became, your other senses tend to compensate for that. I got obsessed with all sorts of sonic.
Well, he was listening to the radio, spending a lot of time listening to the radio, and decided he was going to.
There's the man with the red t-shirt. You see him?
He decided he was going to write a sort of. It's a bit like a radio play, isn't it?
Yeah.
Crossed with music. Called I Trawl the Megahertz.
It's a wonderful, fantastic record. Which is a kind of combination of classical music and narrative, isn't it?
The American girl voice tells this very personal story.
I've got a lot of time for it.
Well, actually, the last Prefab Sprout album a few years ago was a wonderful record.
Yeah.
Andromeda Height.
Great record.
Yeah.
And also, you know, for these very sensitive, quite complicated songs, delicate embroidery, they managed to reproduce it really effectively in the studio. You know, so what are the chances of that? So many people couldn't reproduce their sound.
Still looking a bit fed up there. Just giving him the old bag.
Slightly narrow and appraising glance there. I don't know if you saw it, viewers. I wouldn't want to be in his shoes. I don't know what he's done. Really beautiful sound, this, isn't it? I heartily recommend that anybody's enjoyed this track should go out and hear that new record.
Yes,
it's very good.
Definitely.
There's the two brothers. Don't they look similar?
Now, it's often said, and fortunately tonight it says it on this piece of green paper, that rock journalists are just frustrated rock stars. I know I am. And Mark still wishes he was Roy Harper. Very few of them are successful in both jobs. Neil Tennant, who fronts our next band, used to work at Smash Hits. Since then, he's had a number one record in Britain, and he's about to have a number one record in America. And the LP's not doing bad either. And here, with a track from it, are the Pet Shop Boys.
It's Neil!
Now, before it goes out of shot, you have to point out that Neil is wearing black jeans and white trainers. Look at that.
I love it. Anybody listening to this, I ought to point out that Dave and myself and Neil worked on the same magazine called Smash Hits in the early 80s. And Neil came into the office one day with a cassette of this song, which we played. The only thing we had to play it back on was the telephone answering machine, which was the highest quality sonic reproduction. He stuck it on, and I said to him with a hollow laugh, I said, Neil, that's not going to do very well. So why not? So it's the same chords as Hanging Around by the Stranglers. A minor, C, G, A minor again. I don't think so, mate. With a laugh. And then Neil left the group. Dave, you invented the Pet Shop Boys. Do you know why?
Go on.
You sent Neil Tennant to interview Sting, or to review Sting playing Shea Stadium.
Yeah.
And Neil was not an enormous Sting and the Police fan. No. And suddenly seemed terribly keen. Oh, yes, Marvis, the Police, can't wait. Got there, do you remember, met Bobby O, the producer, and did a little deal with him, and produced a demo.
Had a record deal.
Got a record deal. But when Neil left Smash Hits, we did, and there was always a tradition where you mocked up the cover of the magazine with some fake cover lines. Yeah. The cover lines on the edition with Neil's face on it when he left in whatever it was, probably 1985, June, it said, "How I tried to form my top pop group, and it all went down the dumper, and I came crawling back to ask for my old job." Back again. By Neil Tennant. And we thought this was hilarious. Because we'd all known so many musicians who'd gone off to try and make it. And we just couldn't believe that anybody we knew would be successful.
And he did.
And he did. And this performance, I have to say, was fantastic.
It was really good. It's a great
really
song.
Good. They are so influential, this group. These were such extraordinary songs. And really early version of this, quite crude visual technology.
Yeah.
It's come very much there. And it really was. You know, they're desperately trying to emulate whatever these Americans are doing. That's just basically a wall of... It's like a television showroom, isn't it?
It's Curry's.
In Curry's in Peterborough High Street. It's a load of TV
You're going to see the test match on six screens in a minute.
I know.
And he's got an Amstrad PC over there on the right.
Yeah. Chris still looking very moody.
That's Neil. Chris used to come
into,
a feature.
That's right. Chris used to come into the Smash Hits office and wait for Neil. You know, couldn't go till 6 o'clock because he's got to finish his interview with Mike Score from a, you know, flock of seagulls. So, Chris, he won't be long. It's the last paragraph. He's got the last paragraph there. They were so good.
They still are.
And they still are, my God. You can see I'm single-minded. I know what I can be. How you feel about it? Come take a walk. And Neil's also, and it's not just, I think, because, you know the guy before he was Stiffler, but he's never managed to shake off that slight self-consciousness about his live performance. He's terribly endearing, you know. You and I have seen him play these huge, great venues like the Wembley Arena and Glastonbury Festival, and he's still got that slightly shambling, shrugging, sorry, it's only us, you know. You've paid your money, I hope we can possibly come up to your expectations. That's a really good performance.
Again, they've not been styled.
The right groove and the right time. No. Well, not judging by Neil's footwear and trouser combination. Yeah. We've got a Tennant solo here on a fairly crude piece of technology called an emulator.
Oh, I remember this so well. The thing I remember, my
abiding memory in the studio.
People are allowed to smoke in the studio. Well, this is the Pogues. Absolutely compulsory. You can't have the Pogues without smoking. It wouldn't be right. What I remember, there she is. Now, I don't know how to pronounce her name. The bass player there is called either Cat or Cot. I think it's pronounced Cot, actually. The thing that struck me was that the group arrived with their various members of their extended family and hangers-on. One of the people they had with them was Elvis Costello, who, in fact, had produced the record. Oh, how wonderful. Elvis was very low-key. Do you remember? Just, you know, not making a big deal about it. He was just there with the gang. And they came off stage after the rehearsal. And Cot came off stage, put down a bass guitar, and sat on his knee. And I can remember thinking, how extraordinary. And this was before one knew that, in fact, they were an item and remained an item for many years, in fact. Lived together, I think, in Ireland, didn't they, for a long time. Fantastic Jem Finer played the banjo, who I was in a group with. Stop me if I'm boring you, Dave. Jem Finer and I were in a group called the Eldorados. Played two concerts as kind of housing benefit type, right on occasions in the King's Cross area in 1980. And he was first saxophone and I was second saxophone in the horn section of the Eldorados. Yeah. He's a lovely guy. Another key member of this group is Spider Stacy, who's playing the whistle. There he is on the right, playing the whistle. Bunch of hard-drinking old boys. And, you know, Shane McGowan, if you look at him now, this was recorded, I think, in 1986. What would that be? 17 years ago. And people used to say at the time, God, when the Pogues are on, I hope old Shane's going to be all right because he's drinking terribly. And these are the days when Checker closed up when his teeth were in quite good shape, actually. And they used to say, oh, yeah, they're drinking, like, you know, ridiculous amounts. The poor old boy can't have long on this earth. Well, you know, he's still going.
He's still here.
Shane McGowan, he's built...
He's in the Keith Richards Creaking Door Club.
He really is in the Creaking Door
Club. My view is that those guys will outlive
him. Look at his teeth. They're great. His dental work, bridge work was pretty impressive at this stage. You meet him now, I'll give you a nasty shot. God, they've made some good records.
They have.
Fairy Tale of New York.
I've only latterly... Fairy Tale of New York is
a masterpiece.
The greatest record ever made.
It's a masterpiece. Kirsty MacColl sings the other vocals. It's a masterpiece.
Yeah. But I've only recently really got into these albums, which makes how long ago, and they're terribly good records.
They haven't dated at all.
No.
And they have a real soul to them.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's so much more of an authentic reawakening of this music that ever was succeeding, the Cheektons and Van Morrison trying to kind of pull this off. But these guys really kind of lived and breathed it. Gone out of focus.
What's gone wrong with the picture? Somebody bashed the telly.
Tom Corcoran, director. Somebody. Why has this gone out of focus, I wonder?
Tom Corcoran throws a slipper at the screen. Sorts it out.
See, I thought it was deliberate. I thought it was really clever. Hey, it's the Pogues. Just put the whole thing out of focus.
Are we near the end?
That's how it looks to the Pogues, Dave. That's how the audience looks to them. We're nearly there, aren't we? I've enjoyed it.
Why not? Should we?
Viewers stroke listeners, we've enjoyed it enormously. God bless you. And if you're driving, don't forget your car. Dirty old town. Dirty old town. Ba 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 ba.